one, is that up? One we can do Facebook, and then one we can keep up on Safari. Which one would you like?
There's no Facebook on here.
Is there Larson's thing? Or Google, yeah. You keep that one up. I'm gonna see if Facebook's on here, and then we can get. I just can't tell what's up. I'm just waiting to find Facebook on here. How is there no Facebook on here?
I don't think it's on there.
Oh, you gotta be kidding. I don't want to use my phone the whole time. But we can. All right, well, okay.
But we're up.
I'll just use my phone. All right, we are live. Here we go. It's just us talking at this point.
All right. Hey, everybody. We were just trying to pull up Facebook so that we could talk to anybody that wants to leave a comment, that has anything they want to mention about the live broadcast right now. We are obviously talking about the Academy Awards. Yep. It is finally Oscar Sunday, so there's a lot to get to. We are going to be talking the fashion. We're going to be talking the actors, everything that you can think of when it comes to the Academy Awards. So thank you so much for hopping on with us on Facebook.
Yes, we want to have fun with you guys, so we do have it all here on Facebook Live. I pulled it up on my phone, so we have some of our viewers here. Feel free to chime in. It doesn't really matter what, even if you're just saying hi, we're watching.
Yeah.
Let us know. Let us know who you think is going to win. Maybe where we have some controversies, maybe where we have an upset. We can never forget 2017's La La Land mishap that happened.
Goodness.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, with Moonlight actually won. And
yeah, that was Moonlight.
Yeah.
That's right.
Oh, that was uncomfortable to say.
It really was. I remember watching that being like, wait, why is everybody rushing the stage? And then they like showed the thing and it was like, wow, this is crazy. So right now you can see on your screen, or we're watching the Oscars with you. Billie Eilish is up on your screen. So you can watch it like we are. We're watching it on Facebook with you guys, and we're watching the actual broadcast. So Billie Eilish up for Song of the Year with her brother there that she's walking with for the Barbie song. I can't think of
what
name.
Was I made for?
Yes.
What Was I Made For from Barbie? And we were just talking before we went live. I didn't realize that Billie Eilish, I guess I had forgotten that she's already won an Academy Award. So I was kind of Googling, would she be the youngest person to win Best Original Song? And they're like, no, but she may be the youngest person to win it twice.
Right,
so,
exactly.
Because if she wins it for Barbie tonight, plus I think they had a song for the James Bond movie,
Movie, yep. And right now on the red carpet, we just saw Jeffrey Wright, but now we have Kirsten Dunst and Jesse Plemons. They were both up for, I believe it was Year of the Dog or something about a dog. I remember that being on Netflix like 2 years ago. American Ferrera.
Everybody looks fabulous, but I love the Barbie pink on America right now. She looks stunning. And the metallic, that seems to be a really big theme this year, is the metallic color.
Yes.
But we are just getting some information that there's a protest that's delaying the red carpet right now. So some of the stars are stuck in traffic as people are trying to make their way into the Academy Awards red carpet. So we're waiting to hear more information about that. We don't know what the protest is over right now, but we'll let you know if we get any updates. But for the people who are on the red carpet already, it's been, like I said, metallic seems to be a big theme, and sparkles. Everything is very sparkly and it's very
and
glossy.
Okay. We like sparkles. It's very it's giving 2000s. I'm just trying to set my phone up here so I can kind of watch your guys's comments as well. You can see Anya Taylor Joy is there in a beautiful metallic. Again, we have lots of shiny metallics happening here.
And
very vintage.
I like it. I think it's kind of flashy. Like, and especially if you're going to an awards show like the Oscars, you want something that's going to stand out in a sea of so many gorgeous dresses and suits. So.
Absolutely. Right now we have Danielle Brooks. She is up for the color purple. I love the train on the dress. And we were just talking about Emma Stone.
Yeah, there she is. So I think she looks stunning. Her makeup and hair is gorgeous. I'm not a big fan of the peplum, the big sort of poofy thing on a dress, but I know I am probably in the minority there. There's a lot of people that love that look. So
you have to have the right shape for that look.
Yeah.
You know, all I know is that I'm not that shape.
Right.
it's one that doesn't translate to news very well. Paul Giamatti up for Best Actor for The Holdovers. Mm-hmm. Did you see The Holdovers?
I didn't.
Oh,
so
it's so cool.
Lindsey has seen all the Best Picture movies, so she is definitely going to be someone I'm leaning on tonight. I've seen three, so I'm not in the dark, but definitely not as knowledgeable as you.
You know, with Paul Giamatti, honestly, if he was not up against Cillian Murphy, he would have this in the bag.
Yeah.
Easily. He did a fabulous performance playing a professor who was basically watching over kids that were left behind after Christmas break.
Yeah.
And it was, that's who Davine Randolph or Rudolph, she's up for Best Supporting Actress. Mm-hmm. She's in the movie as well. She will likely win this one. She's won every other award. But the movie itself, it was very like 70s. It was very, it reminded me of Ebenezer Scrooge staying
yeah.
home from
yes.
Christmas. It was a beautiful movie. And he's on the screen right now talking. He's very cleaned up.
I know. It's always interesting to see the sort of the difference in what the women show up in,
yeah.
and then it's a sea of black suits.
Sometimes right,
every time. Or black tuxes.
Yes.
So sometimes you'll see something mix it up. But we are, Vanessa Hudgens is helping with the pre-show right now.
Yes.
And people are saying she is pregnant.
Yes.
So that is super exciting for her, if true. And
she looks beautiful.
Yeah, she looks gorgeous. Oh. So.
She's born to be a host. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
She does. She's done so many other things, like the Oscars pre-watch party.
Yeah.
She's also done the Halloween Boo Spectacular at Disney.
Yeah.
I've seen her do that in the past, so it's pretty exciting. But you guys have commented here. You ladies look great. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
We are grabbing outfits from our closet. We're
yeah.
No new clothes.
Reduce, reuse, recycle.
Yes,
so
very thrifting this
it's,
year. So.
It's always fun to dress up, but
yes.
we wanted to make sure we weren't going too crazy. This
right.
is our sort of ballot that has all of the different categories that people
yes.
could win awards in, and there's a lot of Oppenheimer on here, in anything from obviously actor in a leading role to sound, which I think they're going to end up sweeping a lot of these categories.
Well, and you almost kind of feel bad when there's a movie that you know is just going to sweep, because they're up against so many other really great movies
yeah.
here.
I think we had a clip that said that this is one of the best years for Best Picture, that there
yes.
were so many really solid movies
right.
that obviously Oppenheimer is likely to win. It looks like they're going to. So I think that we'll end up seeing what happens, but it is so
exciting. Do want to put up a Vanessa Hudgens red carpet photo. We have that here up on our Facebook Live.
Oh, there she is.
Oh,
yeah,
I love
she's
yeah, definitely.
Touching her bump, yeah.
Oh,
we couldn't see. It was a little hard in our monitor when
right.
we were first talking, so I didn't want to be insensitive. But,
right, no,
yeah,
absolutely.
She's pregnant.
No, and she announced it as well.
She did, okay.
So it wasn't like we were, yes. I mean, and she definitely looks wonderful. She, I think her boyfriend's a baseball player, a professional baseball player, so
yeah.
I know they've been together for about a year. Why I know this information, I don't
yeah,
know.
Yeah, her first child, so congratulations to her. That's so exciting.
So we do have
all right,
comments.
We're also looking at Wolfgang Puck right now
oh,
on
yes.
your screen. He is one of the people on the red carpet at the moment, so
yes.
maybe he's... Do they get? I don't think they get dinner at the Academy Awards. I was gonna say,
I think
is he
they
gonna?
They do. They should.
They do at the Golden Globes, but I'm like, he might be judging the meal.
Right. Jamie Lee Curtis infamously won last year Best Supporting Actress for her role in Everything Everywhere All at
yeah.
Once. That year, that was the movie that did the sweep. That was also the year that Kiwi won for Best Supporting
yeah.
Actor. Stephanie Hsu was up for Best Supporting Actress. And
well,
it was,
and Jamie Lee Curtis's speech was so just sweet, where she
yes.
was like. Finally, or I can't believe this is happening. Yeah.
Yes.
It really gives you that push that you know that
you made
you
it.
Can always follow your dreams, even
yes.
if it doesn't happen on your timeline, it will happen if you really
yes.
push yourself. So.
I love that. It doesn't have to happen on your timeline. So we also are looking at
Leah Lewis in pink.
Ooh. A lot
perhaps,
of Barbie pink.
Oh, she was a voice in Pixar's Elemental, nominated for Best Animated Feature. So not
that.
A Barbie pink, but maybe it is.
It's
you know?
A, yeah,
yeah
that,
she'd
like,
be channeling it.
Got that Claire's 2000 vibe going. I think we're really channeling those early 2000s.
Yeah, it looks, it's hard to see from our vantage point,
right.
but it looks flowy and floral. But
it looks beautiful.
Very cute.
So you can see Vanessa Hudgens is back up here. She is a chatting right now, you can see, and we got Eva Longoria there. You can see American Ferrera there at the bottom. I'm just looking at our bigger monitor we
yeah.
have next here.
Oh,
and
Eva
Simu
Longoria
Liu.
Looks stunning.
Yes, I loved him in Barbie. He was like the
yes.
other Ken.
He
oh,
was
that
so
was
good.
Great. There was all the Kens. And Eva Longoria, beautiful in the black there, kind of that like hourglass silhouette. Beautiful.
Yeah, yeah, I like that neckline. That's really cool.
That is fun. Oh, yeah, with like the... It has like that little up thing. Oh wow, there's more of
yeah.
the sparkles.
And Eva Longoria was the director of Flamin' Hot, which was nominated for Best Original Song. I actually watched that on, I think it's on Hulu.
Okay.
And it was really good. It was about like the origin story of Flamin' Hot Cheetos.
Oh my gosh, that's this, right. Stop
this
it.
Immigrant family kind of worked to get it into stores.
Right.
That he worked for a chip company and kind of got his foot in the door and talked to the CEO and whatnot. So
what
it was
a
really
story.
Cool. Yeah.
Like, and
great
think about
story.
It, like a simple concept that people were asking for.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They wanted something hot. I think that's great. You got
all right, Jack
Quaid. I love Jack Quaid.
Still got Vanessa Hudgens up there too. So people are making their way in. But as we mentioned, there's a protest that's kind of slowing people down
yeah.
over by the Dolby Theater right now. So some of the
Brittany Snow.
Yeah, Brittany Snow. I love the yellow. That
I love
looks
her.
Beautiful.
I love Brittany Snow. Danielle Brooks again, Color Purple. Jack Quaid was in Oppenheimer.
Mm-hmm.
He was actually just one of those random guys that just popped in there when they were about to do all the equations and get.
That was
together.
The whole movie. I felt like every other scene, I was like. Josh
Wait,
Peck,
Josh,
like Rami Malek.
Rami Malek,
I'm like,
yes.
All
yes.
of these people that you did not, like, I guess, obviously we knew that it was star-studded, but I was shocked to see so many just random stars,
right.
You know what I mean?
And Josh Peck, an integral moment of the movie.
I know.
He's like sweating, you
yeah.
know, like pushing the button, getting ready.
He's got to think that's
oh,
like
Rita
his
Moreno.
Biggest moment.
I love that, because,
oh,
you
yeah.
know, was it 2 years ago that they did West Side Story? Was that 2 years ago?
It was... Maybe more. Two. It might be longer
oh,
than that
gosh.
By now. Yeah.
I'm forgetting which year is which,
yeah.
but we all know that she won.
Alex said on the chat, I feel really good about Oppenheimer. I saw yeah. that movie and it was fantastic watch. I
yes.
agree. I actually saw it when...
show. Makes it a little bit easier.
And she helps produce his late night show, so she has a lot of
experience. I love that it's a family. That's really special. I don't think you could do a job like that without it being a part of your family.
Yeah.
But I know that it just takes a lot of extra work, and I feel like it's almost like the Barbie monologue. You can't be too funny, but you can't be mean, but not too mean, but you have to be funny with being mean without interfering
as
with the
host.
People.
As the host. I keep losing my ballot.
There you go. I
got to put it down over here.
Yes. So we are looking
at... Let's take another look at... we can bring up some of the nominees. We know one of the first-time nominees are... There's actually a lot of them. Emily Blunt.
Crazy.
There's 10. Lily Gladstone, Danielle Brooks, Sandra Hewler, Sterling K. Brown, Cillian Murphy.
I can't believe
that's his first time.
How
because
is that
he's
his
been...
First?
I feel like he's so...
Iconic?
Yeah. And
he's been in so much of Christopher Nolan's work. And I'm not saying just because you're a part of Christopher Nolan's work, you automatically get nominated, but you kind of hope you do.
Yeah. Also, Colman Domingo is a first-time nominee. Daveen Joy Randolph, America Ferrera, Jeffrey Wright. So a lot of people hoping to take home their first Oscar today.
Jeffrey Wright.
A couple people do it, so some people are going to be sad.
You know, and I mean, there's some clear winners. I mean, I don't know how you're beating Cillian Murphy today.
I
hate to say it, as much as I really want Paul Giamatti to do well, Cillian Murphy's performance in Oppenheimer was just almost ghostly. It was terrifying and well thought. Like, I don't know how he did that. He lost a lot of weight for the role to emulate the stress of being a scientist that was covering...
And he's such a good actor that actors, like, acts with his face. And someone else who does that is Lily Gladstone, who is a first-time nominee. I just finished Killers of the Flower Moon this week. I actually split it up into 2 days
because
it's so long.
You have to. It is so long. But when you're watching it, you don't feel like it's that long. It's a great story.
It was really good. And she was fantastic. I mean, like I said, it's a lot of acting with your eyes and your, like, mouth and emotions without saying too much, just kind of feeling the emotions that she has, feeling the pressure that she was under, the illness too.
And she really held her own against some heavyweights, Robert De Niro, Leonardo DiCaprio. Robert De Niro also getting nominated Best Supporting Actor.
Yeah, I can't believe Leo didn't get nominated, but I mean, he's very famously
not
won things, so maybe it's just another snub.
He has his Oscar. I think he's fine now. He has his Oscar for The Revenant. I think that was 2013.
It's been a while. I think that was pre-COVID, so
it was definitely
it feels pre-COVID. Like a lifetime ago.
Yes. I remember when he did that role, and I was like, all right, Leo, this is it for you.
Yeah.
Like, he's like eating like raw elk or something in the wilderness.
I know.
Who was the blonde with Ryan Gosling? I missed that. I have to look back up on that
one. We didn't see. Let's take a look. We also can talk about Emma Stone. She's nominated.
Yes.
She has had 5 Oscar nominations.
Oh, you can put it back up. There she is.
Tonight, she is up for Best Picture and Actress, and she previously won Best Actress for La La Land, which is one of my favorite movies of all time. I loved La La Land. I remember when I saw it in the theaters, it was one of those movies where I left, and I was like, all right, I want to quit my job, move to LA,
and just
follow my dreams and become an actress.
Like. Yes, and there she is. How beautiful, right?
Yeah,
there she is.
Looking gorgeous, and I wonder, like, if she's nervous. If she's been nominated 5 times, is this kind of like, it's another Sunday?
Day. Yeah. Right. Well, and I remember looking at some of the who's going to win. Mm-hmm. It is so paper thin close. With Lily Gladstone and Emma Stone.
Yeah.
Emma Stone obviously being in Poor Things. I mean, quite frankly, she was great. She created an entire character of a being that came to life, and it was like a human that was starting over. Like, she had like a baby's brain, and she was learning everything as an adult, basically all over again. And how do you even begin as an actress? How do you even start?
Unbelievable.
Right.
Yeah.
It was a great
Also, project. Emma Stone is the second woman nominated for acting and Best Picture for the same film. Following Frances McDormand in Nomadland, which was 2020, so has not happened very often.
Right, absolutely, and I think we just saw who we got there. Regina King, love Regina.
Oh my gosh, I love that dress.
Oh, that is gorgeous. Beautiful. You can never go wrong with a red dress on the red carpet.
Yeah. But what's interesting is sometimes who wins Golden Globes can sort of tip us off as to what the Academy will do, but it doesn't. Always translate
because they break it up between musical and drama. So you might have like you might have somebody that wins, like Emma Stone might win in a comedy because they considered Poor Things a comedy, and then you had Divine Joy Randolph win for drama actress. So they both have won almost an equal amount here,
yeah,
which
yeah.
is wild. I wonder, let us know what you guys think, who's going to win. I believe that would be Florence Pugh. Love her. Oh, she's like my
yeah.
new favorite. She's like the new Jennifer Lawrence to me.
Really?
I mean, I love J-Lo.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I love Jennifer Lawrence. Florence Pugh, I feel like, there's Cillian Murphy.
We do have some sound for you guys to listen to from our expert moviegoer,
yes.
which is Christopher Pollard with Milwaukee Film and the movie podcast Cinebuds. He was actually talking to us on Flick Picks this week, which is a segment we do every week on 12 News This Morning. So he is going to talk to us about his favorites to win Best Picture and some other categories. Let's listen.
Oppenheimer is going to sweep. I think we all know that. The Best Picture, Best Director, I think Best Actor too. A lot of technical awards for sure. Hollywood loves an epic spectacle. It's a period piece as well. That's like a formula for an Oscar. Plus, it's won over 300 awards already. I didn't even know you could win 300 awards, but apparently they have. But in the history of the Oscars, the Best Picture, Best Director often go together. That makes sense. But in the last 30 years, six different times it's split. So perhaps Yorgos Lanthimos could pull it out if the Poor Things fans want to see both of them represented. So it seems unlikely, but it happens. I also think Divine Joy Randolph is a shoe-in to best Supporting Actress. She's won every major cinema award for this performance so far, and she absolutely deserves it. So I think those are for sure.
All right, so you heard it. Oppenheimer's already won 300 awards, Christopher said, so it's kind of tipping us off that we will probably be seeing some more awards one tonight,
right.
but you just never know.
There always could be an upset. I mean, honestly, if Oppenheimer doesn't win Best Picture, is it Killers of the Flower Moon? Is
yeah.
it American Fiction? Is it Poor Things? I feel like there's, if you rule out Oppenheimer for just a second,
right.
what could be the next best one?
I know, and that's what Alex is asking right now. He says, who do you two think can
yeah.
challenge Oppenheimer? I would say Killers of the Flower Moon,
I think
but
I even picked Killers of the Flower Moon. That's an upset.
I personally feel like, and we talked about this before we went live, I loved the first half of the movie. I literally went to work the next day and was telling people, like, I think I like this more than Oppenheimer.
Yeah.
Like, this is really good so far. But then when I watched the second half, it was still good, but it dragged out way too long.
Right.
I think it didn't need to be 3.5 hours. They could have made some edits here and
Nobody
there.
Nobody says no to Martin Scorsese.
Yeah, I guess so. So I think if they had kind of kept that momentum that they had
sure.
in the first half, that it could definitely have been one of the best of all time.
And I think when you're watching it, you're still kind of wondering what exactly is happening. I think by halfway through, you know. So I feel like maybe that's why it feels like, okay, let's just get to it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not going to spoil it for anybody. Don't worry. Oh, speaking of Ariana Grande, there she is on the screen.
Yeah,
wearing
there
her pink
she is.
As well. Lots of Barbie pink
she's
going on.
She's blonde because she's been playing Glinda the Good Witch
yeah.
in Wicked, which is coming out this year or next year?
Is it April? I know it's two parts.
So,
Larson, let us know when Wicked's coming out.
Yeah.
And Ariana Grande. He's going to look it up. He's our producer in the back. We want to give him a shout out for putting together.
But she's in
all these
pink.
Graphics.
Is that for Glinda or is that for Barbie? That's been the big question all night. Is are people
yes.
in pink for Barbie or something else?
I always wonder how they can wear these humongous dresses. She can barely hold a microphone. It looks
I
like
know.
She's hanging onto a
It looks like
bag,
a comforter.
Like a comforter.
April 27th, Wicked's coming up. November 27th.
Thank you.
Sorry,
November
27th.
So that will be part one. There's actually in two parts. So interesting.
I'm surprised it's taken them this long because
my phone's telling me I spent my daily limit of 30 minutes on Facebook. Uh-oh. We're just going to not listen to that today. So I'm looking here.
Oh, Gino's commenting.
Oh, yes. Gino says here, from the nominations of an actor in a leading role, I've only seen Oppenheimer from the remaining films, Maestro, Rust, and The Holdovers in American Fiction. Which two would you recommend for me to watch next?
I never saw American Fiction, but it's still on my list. I still really want to see it. And everyone I've talked to who has seen it is like, it was amazing. It was so good
it
to watch.
It was so good. Honestly, Gino, I would say Holdovers in American Fiction, quite frankly, they're both really good.
Yeah.
Holdovers is a little bit more heartwarming. American Fiction is a little bit more of today's realistic world.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of gives you a gut punch right away in the beginning, and then that kind of sets the tone for the rest of the movie. Jeffrey Wright does an amazing job, and if you think you've seen him from something, I thought that when I was watching it. He was in The Hunger Games Catching Fire as BT.
Oh, wow.
So he was
yeah.
the guy that was getting all the electricity and the
oh
wires
my gosh.
Together. Why I know this, I don't know.
Yeah, I'm like, of course you zeroed in on that right
I have
away.
I zero in on it. So it was so wonderfully done.
We have Mark Ruffalo on the screen right now. So if you're watching live on WISN, you can see Kenosha Native talking about him being at the Oscars. He's nominated tonight.
Yep.
Not looking great odds for him to win, but we'll see.
No, but you know what? I think he just got his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
Yeah.
You know, he was in Poor Things, opposite of Emma Stone. He kind of played a character that kind of takes her away from where she's living to kind of, I don't want to say take advantage of her naivety, but also kind of wants her to experience the world. Mm-hmm. So a very against type role for him. Also, he has had previous nominations and The Kids Are All Right from 2010. I remember Foxcatcher in 2014 and Spotlight. Do you remember Spotlight?
I saw Foxcatcher and Spotlight loved both of them. Obviously, we are in the journalism business, so
right.
Spotlight was very interesting to us. It was something that was going to pique our interest, but there's a reason why it won a lot of stuff.
Absolutely.
That year,
that
or at least was nominated.
McAdams.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Thanks, Jason. You're the best.
We have a cameo.
I'll make a little stirring.
Some fresh water.
And thanks to Jason.
Thank you, Jason.
Yes.
Cheers.
Yes.
Glass of water.
So we also have on the screen right now Lisa Ray, who is up there with Emma Stone. Again, I love the metallics. I wish I would have got the memo.
I know. Everybody's in metallic and sequins and glitter.
Your earrings are glittery.
I know. The earrings are glittery.
And,
I have gold shoes on, but you can't see those. So.
Everyone put your foot up. No,
But let us know in the comments, what movies have you guys seen?
Yes.
What are you keeping your fingers crossed for? Because obviously, just because you saw Oppenheimer doesn't mean that you think it should win.
Right.
You know what I mean? What was your favorite?
Movie.
You've seen all of the Best Picture nominees.
Yes.
What was your favorite?
You know, as a moviegoer, I would say Barbie, because I found it the most enjoyable to go watch. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of times with Oscar movies, I go see them because I know they're going to get nominated, and I know we do this every year, and I want to know.
Yeah.
But like the movie that I actually wanted to see, you can right now on your screen, you see Cynthia. I always
Erivo.
Erivo, yes. Beautiful look there. I believe she's playing isn't she playing the bad witch from Cinderella? Or not Cinderella? Oh my gosh.
Wicked.
Yes, I believe she's the one playing the bad witch in it with Ariana Grande. But when it comes to, like I was mentioning, like Best Pictures, Barbie, I think, was my favorite like experience to watch. But Oppenheimer, just because of the scale of that movie, I don't know how it can't win.
Right.
Against Killers of the Flower Moon. So if you guys hear a lot of stuff, we have a lot of people here at the Oscar watch party. We have lots of gorgeous people.
You're looking at a picture of Julianne Hough now. She is on the red carpet interviewing some of the stars. If you're watching on WISN 12, you can see she's interviewing Billie Eilish.
I love her
right
dress.
Now, talking about the best original song that her and her brother are up for the Barbie movie.
And we're getting to the countdown, and we are literally like seconds away from the opening of the Oscars.
So I know.
While it's doing the opening, we are not going to talk. We're going to watch it with you as Jimmy Kimmel does his monologue. So we'll watch it here as we get to the next segment here. But right now, you got the Eilishes there. You got Phineas.
I do wonder, though, if they are trying to pause, because, like we mentioned, there's a protest happening right outside the Dolby Theater that's really backing up traffic, and some of the stars cannot get in. I'm trying to think. We haven't even seen Cillian Murphy.
Oh, I saw Cillian Murphy.
Oh, you did?
Yep,
okay.
Yep,
I was like, maybe he's stuck in his car somewhere.
No, I didn't see Jennifer Lawrence yet. I know she's one of the presenters.
Yeah, we haven't seen her. We did see Emily Blunt and her husband, who I always confuse with.
John Krasinski
and Jason Sudeikis in my brain are the same person. I can never remember. But we can see people are running into the theater right now behind Vanessa Hudgens. So
there she goes.
Pretty funny. People are trying to get to their seats.
I think they're trying to stall. Did you see Julianne Hough just run into the screen? I love her dress, though.
All right, they are signing off, Julianne Hough and Vanessa Hudgens. They are saying goodbye, which means we are like a commercial breakaway. Not even, here it goes.
Okay.
Never mind, we are a commercial breakaway.
And there's a fridge.
And
that's
I was wrong.
At night, no, not that, but. All right, so let's see. Gino said that Killers of the Flower Moon was 3 hours and 26. Did you have a hard time focusing without any break?
Yeah.
Or is my attention span?
No, Gino, I was literally saying, like, I thought it was way too long. I saw the first half, was loving it, and had to pause it. I was like, all right, I'll watch like 90 minutes tonight and 90 minutes tomorrow
and
or whatever.
The hard part was you watch that 90 minutes and you're like, I still have another 90 minutes
left. I know. I think it definitely there's some of these movies where I'm like, because what we do for work is we write stories that then are edited down. So sometimes you give your producer a story that's 2 minutes and they cut it down to a minute 30 or less. So we know you write to edit, and sometimes I feel like these Oscar movies need a little bit more in the screenplay. Yes. My question though is, do you think that when they first have the screenplay, is it 5 hours long and then it gets cut down? Or is it always like 2 hours and then gets added?
A chance to see tickets to John Ridley's screening of Shirley that is at the Oriental Theater. It is a celebration.
Milwaukee. If you want to see Shirley, the big premiere here in Milwaukee, you can enter now for your chance to win those free tickets. It's a celebration, a VIP reception. So I'm assuming you like the movies.
You might be a movie. So just go to our app. Also, you can go to WISN.com. You can do that, and you'll be able to win the chance to win those, which would be an amazing experience. Oriental Theater is so fancy. It's so beautiful. I mean, I don't know who would want to win that.
Yeah. Well, and news we had this week, or maybe it was last week, but that the Downer Theater is reopening because Milwaukee Film is taking over that theater space, which closed, I think, in the fall.
Yes.
So it'll be exciting to have another theater like that opening up for us to go see.
Absolutely. More options for everybody, and I think that, you know, as we are kind of reopening after the pandemic, I think a lot of these little spaces are going to open back up, and it just kind of gives Milwaukee that beautiful quality of like a hominess. So
yeah,
yes, we are just anticipating that opening here. I know it's happening at some point. We're watching a preview for The Bachelor at the moment. I know you're a Love Is
Which
Blind
is also
fan.
Dramatic.
Right,
yeah.
It is dramatic. Yeah.
Best drama, The Bachelor.
But, all right, so we're getting very close to the beginning here. We want you guys to continue to comment. Let us know what you think once Jimmy starts. Think about some of the jokes. Let us know what you think of his monologue, because, you know, we should really be on Twitter, too.
I know.
We should be watching Twitter, because at the same time, we're going to be watching our Facebook Live here.
Well, and answer my question, what do you guys think? Do you think that a screenplay starts as 5 hours long and then gets cut down from there? Or does it start as, like, 2 hours and then another hour gets added after edits?
Well, and how much did they actually film if the whole movie was 3.5? Like, did they actually film 5 hours of content?
There's got to be at least. Like, you know, I mean, there's hundreds of hours that get filmed, you know, because they do so many takes, they do so many different angles of the same shot, you know what I mean, the same line, so.
And to maintain that, to maintain the intensity of each scene, I don't know how.
Yeah.
That's why they do what they do.
Do you want to do some trivia, Lindsey, or should we wait?
I think we should wait till after the monologue happens
and we can react to that, and then we'll have a little bit of downtime.
Absolutely.
That we can knock some of these questions out.
If you could put up maybe the best picture nominees while we're waiting here, that would be great until it starts. We can just see who's nominated again. We have 10 different best picture categories. We have 10 up for best picture. Again, we have American Fiction, Anatomy of a Fall, Barbie, The Holdovers, Killers of the Flower Moon, Maestro, Oppenheimer, Past Lives, Poor Things, and The Zone of Interest up for Best Picture. I believe this might be the opening. Yes.
All right, here comes the beginning of the Oscars. Mark, I'm Mallory, this is Lindsey. So you're joining us now. I know they have the camera on kind of a a crowd shot right now. So I want to introduce you once we can pull up everybody.
We're going to get the camera turned around and we'll get you here on our screen. Thank you for joining us. Yeah, this is wonderful. Yeah, we love having guests on here with us. We can get a little more insight onto the industry.
Yeah.
There we go. Here comes Jimmy.
All right, so I think they're trying to get it. So we saw you and then we saw us.
Yes,
there we go. They're trying to get us all in the same shot. So tell us who you are, what you're doing here. Just give us a little rundown.
Okay, my name is actually Mark. I'm a local filmmaker from Milwaukee. And I just had my film screened at No Studios at the Filmmaker Showcase.
That is amazing. What an accomplishment. What did that feel like to be able to sort of see your work on a screen like that?
Oh, it was really nice. And I was very happy to be able to like share with my friends and family community and have everybody see it and like sit in a dark room together and experience something, you know.
Yeah. And what is the movie? Tell us about sort of the premise. And
My film is about a girl who's hitchhiking because she's just left her husband. She falls in love with a stranger who picks her up, and then they get back to Milwaukee and she finds out that he has a whole life outside of her. So it's kind of like a coming of age story about a young adult. And I like very much projected my own experiences onto that. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I think in order to deep dig in, you kind of have to have something in your personal life. And I think that would likely show through your movie.
Yeah.
So how did you cast it? That's
put out a professional casting call, but I ended up casting one of my childhood friends as the lead, the stranger that she gets in the car with. And a friend of a friend, a filmmaker's like kind of muse. So it's people I kind of were familiar with already, so that kind of helped because it's like about Milwaukee, it's about coming of age. So
Are you a Milwaukee native, I'm assuming?
Yeah.
And what was it like to, did you also film it in this area? Did you go somewhere else?
Yeah, we mostly filmed it here, Racine, Oak Creek, Wisconsin Dells, but it's very like local.
That's awesome. And I know we've been talking about John Ridley, who founded No Studios. He's really been pushing for more money towards filmmaking in the state of Wisconsin.
Is that local?
Yeah.
Very important.
Is that something that you would like to see here, is more like independent films?
Of course, yeah. I would love to be involved in more independent films, make my own independent films, and I just love the community we have here.
That's exciting. Yeah. What else is on the docket? Are you already working on the next movie?
Yeah. I'm working on a few short films with local makers, and I'm working on writing and directing my own next film as well.
And what's your goal? Like, do you want to stay local, or do you want to go to LA? You want to go to Louisiana, Atlanta? What do you want to do?
I'm definitely going to stay local for the next few years, but I think I would move somewhere else, maybe New York or LA in the future. But I'm just very passionate about movies. Would love to shoot feature-length films.
Yeah. So what's it like to... Are you someone that always watches the Academy Awards each year?
Yeah, I do. I'll admit I love the red carpet more than the actual. Okay, I like seeing all the outfits. Yeah, but I love like the Academy Awards for sure.
Yeah, what are your predictions? Have you seen some of the best pictures?
I have. I think like Oppenheimer is going to make a big scene. Personally, my favorite film I saw this year was probably either Poor Things or Priscilla, which are both like kind of coming of age stories with like amazing costuming and direction. So that's who I'm rooting for.
Yeah.
I think, and I wish Priscilla would have got nominated a little bit more. Yeah, as well, because I think it kind of got lost in a lot of the best picture nominations.
It's
a tough year
to have a movie in. Yeah.
Absolutely. Oh, that's wonderful.
As for directors, is there anybody that really inspires you that you look up to?
Directors, I would say Sofia Coppola is a big inspiration for me. I also love Greta Gerwig. I love Lady Bird, and Barbie was great, of course. Yeah.
I love Lady Bird. I loved that year with Saoirse Ronan. Loved that movie so much. It was such an honest coming of age story.
It's very like vulnerable.
And I think there's a lot of that with Greta Gerwig, so Little Women as well. It's just a lot of that feeling, and that people can relate to it.
Yeah,
so that's great.
Mm-hmm. How did you even get into sort of filmmaking? What was your path to get here today?
So I went to a local after school program called True School when I was in high school, and I actually teach there part time now as a video production instructor. But I took video production courses and learned basic shooting editing, and then I went to college at UW-Milwaukee for film.
How did you feel about your experience at UW-Milwaukee? What made you be able to succeed by going through their program?
I had a great time there. It's a great program. I think my favorite part was collaborating with other makers, and like the filmmaking process, all about collaboration, working together.
Okay.
That's my favorite part about the experience.
Especially with Willem Dafoe being an alum. Excitement.
Yes, he gave out the diplomas the semester before I graduated, so I was so darn it, you know. Yeah.
If only.
Yeah.
But you know what? You're probably more likely to meet him someday than the rest of us.
Yeah. And so you said, what is the film called that you just came out?
My film is called Rearview Mirror.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, I like that.
Yeah, thank you.
I feel like a new look
back in the past.
Yeah.
Get
Olivia Rodrigo soundtrack. No,
yes.
How did you sort of, if anybody else maybe has an idea of wanting to direct a film or their own screenplay, what would you say is your best advice to sort of make that a reality, to get it actually on a screen?
I would say bringing in people who are, you know, more talented than you, know more than you, and like looking up to them and like getting their insight and like getting a lot of feedback from people. But still, yeah, just going and making it and like doing the darn thing, you know?
Yeah, that's so cool. Well, thank you so much for talking to us. It's so cool to get your perspective as somebody in the industry and chatting about it. We wish you nothing but success. That's
thank
so exciting. You,
you
already
we're
have
gonna
a movie out.
Hope so.
Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
I can steal that.
All right, guys, we are still doing our Oscars watch party live here from Nope Studios. We are watching Jimmy Kimmel right now. He is kind of just doing his thing. We kind of missed a little chunk of it there here, but he's talking about Emma Stone at the moment. And you can see the watch party here in the other room.
Yeah, you're looking at some people that are sitting in really comfy chairs watching the Oscars.
That's where you want to be. So most of the audience is actually out by us, but there's a couple people that have already settled in. There's popcorn in the back. There's drinks in the back.
And look at this.
Cheers.
A special guest.
Oh, my God. Hello. Hi. Good to be here.
Yeah, we're good to see you. How's it going?
It's been a day, but, like, we're here.
Yeah,
so
you made it.
I'm here. Great to be here. Happy Oscar Sunday.
Yeah.
You guys look fantastic.
So do you. Love the velvet.
Thank you
and
so
the
much.
Bow tie is so cute.
Thank you so much. Is there anybody who you guys saw on the red carpet who you were like absolutely killed it?
Emily Blunt, we thought looked stunning.
Emily Blunt.
Yeah. She has this like gold metallic dress on that just looks so good.
Yeah.
She's so, I mean, Emily Blunt is also a character who I feel like we love her so much. I mean, like, obviously she's nominated tonight for Best Actress, but she was, I feel like Emily Blunt, back to Devil's Wear Prada, right?
Yeah, I know, right?
When she was not recognized for that.
Right.
And, like, she's such a fantastic actress.
Yeah.
She has such range, and I love her so much. But
yeah.
I have not been able to see all of the red carpet looks yet.
I know,
so far,
you're
so.
In the dark.
Yeah,
but America Ferrera had on a really beautiful metallic pink dress. Yeah,
yes.
So
yes.
For Barbie.
Love America Ferrera.
I didn't see
Margot Robbie, though. Cisa Puente, gotta kick it up, right?
Yes.
The real fans will know, gotta kick it up, back
and
in on the Disney Channel.
Fans.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah, for sure.
She was great. So Ariana Grande, oh, there's Jodie Foster right there. She's nominated for NIAID, along with Annette Bening.
That was actually a fabulous movie about NIAID, the swimmer that swam from Florida, or Cuba to Florida. I actually had a chance to see that, and it was really hard. Honestly, Jodie Foster is in really good shape, y'all.
Oh my gosh.
Like,
Jodie Foster is
cow.
Another one of those actresses who, like, you watch forever, right?
Yeah, I know.
Like, I've seen her in so many great films.
Yes.
We're taking a look at Lily Gladstone. Right
yes,
now,
oh, love
who
her.
Could make history tonight as the first Native American actress to win an Oscar.
Yeah.
But back to
Jodie Foster.
Jodie Foster.
Yeah.
Flight Plan?
Yes.
Panic Room.
Panic Room. Yep.
She was literally nominated for an
movies.
Academy Award as a child.
Yeah.
So right.
She
yes.
has been
Taxi Driver,
killing it for years, and just has such a storied career.
Silence
so
of the
exciting.
Lambs.
Oh, we do have Lily Gladstone. A
there
little info
is.
About her. This is her first nomination. She did win the Golden Globe and the SAG Award. So those are two things that usually can kind of tip off who might win the Academy Award, but you just never know. There's so many upsets.
And this was one of the shows, this was one of the movies that I really wanted to watch. And
oh,
I have
yes.
not yet seen The Killers of the Flower Moon. I've not yet seen it, so.
It's a long one, but it's good.
I know, it took you multiple days over a week.
It took me three days. I watched an hour
days,
each day.
Right. And so I really do want to watch that. I want to see it because, first of all, the plot just looked phenomenal, but also
it
to
is.
Have this history-making, these history-making actors.
Yeah, nominations, potential wins, and the story itself is a tragic, true story.
It's a hard movie to watch. It is, it's like gut punch after gut punch, and you just wonder how much more a person can take. And the way Lily Gladstone plays this role, with just like this stoicness, and she just like holds it all in the entire movie, and you're just wondering what is going to happen next. How can this woman, how can this nation, the Osage Nation, handle more of this heartbreak? Right. It is a phenomenal movie. It is very long, yeah. As Mallory has said, it could have used some editing.
I do. I was talking about, I was like, we write stories for the news packages that you give it to somebody and it's 2.5 minutes, and then it gets cut down to 1:30. Yeah. I'm like, they should have done that with Coach of Farmers. But still a great movie.
I can see that.
There's Steven Spielberg on the screen there.
Steven Spielberg, for sure, yeah.
Oh my gosh,
like, we love
legend.
Him. Okay, so I love the Steven Spielberg, Captain Bigelow history/drama, because they were obviously a couple, Steven Spielberg and Captain Bigelow. And she won in
18?
But she won for Zero Dark Thirty.
You're thinking of James Cameron.
Oh, am I thinking
Catherine
of James
Bigelow? Yes.
Okay, that's
you're
fine.
Okay. I was like, Steven Spielberg has been married a long
okay,
time.
I was like,
James Cameron.
Lindsey can keep me honest. Yeah. Right. Yeah. It was James Cameron and Catherine Bigelow.
Yes.
But she made history and
yes. I think it was 2016.
When she won for
Zero Dark Thirty with
Jessica
Chastain.
Yep. Yeah. I'm a big fan of Catherine Bigelow for sure. Yeah.
She was
a
trailblazer.
I'm a big James Cameron fan too.
How are you not?
Titanic is one of my favorite movies of all time.
I think it is my favorite movie. Like every time it's on the table, I cannot turn it off.
I know.
I'm like, well, I guess I'm here for another 3 hours.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. As a kid, I would watch it and I would turn it off before the iceberg would hit. Spoiler alert. Because I wanted to pretend that they made it.
Yeah.
Well, the way that I did it, it was 2 VHS.
Yeah, I remember the 2 VHS.
I would skip the first VHS and go straight.
You went right to the drama.
To the ship sinking. Yeah. Yeah.
And
like,
I only watched
the first part.
I only watched the first part.
So we're when they're running through the Titanic, all that stuff. Oh. It's so good.
Yeah. And you know what's special about that movie is that the Titanic itself is a character. He was able to create that whole model in Mexico and create that whole. It's so one. Can we watch Titanic right now?
I know. I will watch Titanic at any moment, at any point.
That's a movie that Titanic didn't need edits. It could be 3 hours.
It's Titanic. Mean Girls is also one of the movies too. Like, if I see it on TV, which is always on like TBS
or TNT,
I will stop and I will
watch
Mean Girls for sure.
Yes. Yeah. It's so good. Jimmy Kimmel's still
so
doing.
How's Jimmy Kimmel been doing so far?
We can't hear him.
Yeah, we're not. We can't hear him yet at this point.
I will see him every time they pan. The audience is chuckling. So
this is his fourth time hosting the Oscars.
Yep.
Do you guys think that you could do a broadcast like this?
Oh my gosh!
Nope.
I don't think so. His wife is the executive producer of the Academy Awards, so I'm
he's getting a standing ovation right now. What did I miss?
I don't know. All these, I think this is maybe the people that help put on the production.
Oh, that's great. Maybe.
Some
that'd
of them
be what
headsets on.
Oh, that's wonderful news.
There's Lily Gladstone. Jimmy
so
Kimmel
beautiful.
There.
I just want
what
to
I thought was kind
wow.
of interesting about Jimmy Kimmel talking.
Yeah, that
he
is.
Did
look
say,
at.
He did say that this would either be his last Oscars or he doesn't know if he's going to come back.
Okay.
Which is interesting. Like,
show?
He's hinted toward this being like the end of his tenure, which I think would be just, I mean, Jimmy Kimmel's fantastic.
Yeah. It looks like he's wrapping up. He just said it's golden time. It's time to give out some Oscars. So the first one, usually they come out of the gate right away with the best supporting actor and actress. So this would be the one that is going to, actor in a supporting role. This is Sterling K. Brown, Robert De Niro, Robert Downey Jr., Ryan Gosling, and Mark Ruffalo.
Oh, wait, these look like actresses though.
I'm so sorry.
Let's see.
Well, usually the supporting actress from the year before will
come out.
We're
going for supporting actress here. I mean, this supporting actress. So a lot of people have said that Divine Joy Randolph is going to
go
with this. This is one of the only movies that I actually saw.
It's so
which
good.
Which was The Holdovers.
It was so
and
good.
And it was a fantastic
it
film.
It was so good.
And it will be interesting to see if Divine Joy Randolph actually takes this one. Mm-hmm. Because I know Danielle Brooks is another actress who, like, Let's listen. Because you have Jamie Lee Curtis. I mean, how can you not listen to her? Let's listen.
Well, and a lot of people loved America Ferrera's
monologue. Right, of course. A good category here.
Hey, Larson, can you put up the best supporting actresses up?
Can you put up the best supporting
actresses on the screen?
Oh,
okay. Hi, Larson.
Hi, our producer Larson is doing a fantastic job over there.
Keeping us on the air.
Keeping us on the
Facebook.
Us on the
yes. Yes, we
discussed
it. And again,
Jamie Lee Curtis won last year for Everything Everywhere All at Once.
Yeah, that's right.
She had an iconic speech about.
Yep.
Oh, wait, who do we have here? We have.
I can't think of it's not Mary Louise.
Actress.
Yes, it's not Mary Louise Parker. I can't think of her.
It's not Molly Shannon.
Nope, nope. But it's on that line.
Yeah, it's right.
Why can't I think of her name? She's fantastic. She's an elf.
Yes. She's in Step Brothers.
Right, she's in Step Brothers. She's in literally everything. She's in like the Brady. For 80 for Brady movie. She's fantastic. She's so great. And I'm blanking
her name
right now.
I know, this is bad.
You guys on Facebook, let us know who this is.
Who this is, please. There's Emily Blunt with her
Emily
husband.
Emily Blunt, she's just so, I love Emily Blunt so much.
She is an Oscar, she's a walking
such
Oscar.
Such a fantastic, oh,
I know. Lupita.
I love Lupita.
Amazing.
Love Lupita. Lupita has been having a time. She's been
Look
having.
Look at her glasses. I've never
Lupita
seen her
Lupita has
glasses.
Been making headlines lately with her boyfriend. What's her name? Josh Jackson?
I don't know.
Is it Josh Jackson?
No, you're thinking of somebody else. You're thinking of his, unless they're together. Oh.
It's Lupita headline. And Josh Jackson, I'm pretty sure, yes.
No,
he just got divorced.
Oh. Jerry's in the dirt.
Headline.
Lupita
Jared.
Is getting her.
Oh.
She's getting it on.
Oh, there's. Oh.
Divine Joy Randolph. Love that.
Oh, how is she not going to win? I'm sorry. I saw it too. And
I do hope she wins. Yes. I hope it's either her or Danielle Brooks, because I think biasly, those are the two.
There's America. Woo!
Yeah. I mean, I saw America Ferrera too and Barbie. Yeah. I did see Barbie, so yeah, there's that.
So this is a different thing than they've done in the past. They're kind of like, instead of having a roll the tape of like a look at what they did in the film, these actresses are out here explaining their roles.
Which is weird because usually it is the last year best supporting actor that will give out the actress.
Right.
That's backwards. It's kind of nice to have the women supporting women kind of thing. I really like that.
The year of Barbie.
Oh. She looks
Did you all
fabulous.
Love Barbie?
Did oh, how do you not Barbie? Love Barbie? Did you Barbie? Saw, you saw
so I did see Barbie. I saw Barbie.
I loved it.
It was a good, feel good. it's a good movie.
It was just
I was
so
surprised
fun.
That it's been as nominated as it has been, though, for Oscars.
Really?
Only because, I don't know. Oh, wait. Shout out, Regina King, who was in Shirley, who was premiering in Milwaukee this week.
Yes, and
we're giving out tickets.
Yes,
we are.
Giving out tickets. Yes, yes,
on the 12 News app.
Regina King, she plays Shirley in the new biopic, Shirley Chisholm, directed by John Ridley. Mm-hmm. Who
we're at No Studios.
We're at
No Studios.
John Ridley
found
No Studios.
It.
Yeah. I am so excited to see Regina King's performance because she is one of those actresses who, she's been in everything. You know?
I know.
She's been in everything since you can remember.
Yeah.
And you never realize, like, oh my gosh, like, it's Regina King, it's Regina King, it's Regina King. And so she's finally stepping, like, not finally, but she's stepping into her...
What she deserves.
What she had she's
coming.
Part producer of Shirley. And
oh,
so,
I love
like,
that.
John, we did an interview with him a couple
months
ago.
Oh, here we
go. He talked about how she was very, how much she wanted to be a part of this.
Divine
Joy Randolph. There we go.
I knew she was going to cry.
Yeah,
Derrick Rose. Derrick Rose is in the house,
Divine
everybody.
Divine Joy Randolph winning her first Oscar.
Not for Elemental, but for The Holdover.
In The Holdovers.
Yeah.
And this
a beautiful
was,
performance.
It really was. It really was such
she
a
She made me cry so many times. Her character played the cook that stayed behind to help the students who had to stay behind, and she lost her son in the war, and it was a really moving, beautiful performance. Let's hear what she has to say.
Let's hear her speech.
Amen. Shout out to Divine Joy Randolph, who is walking away with her first Oscar.
Oh, I got goosebumps.
After her first nomination.
She won the BAFTA, the Golden Globe, and she's a Tony nomination as well. Yeah. So she could have an EGOT at some point.
Maybe.
Yeah, she's well on her way, right?
Yeah, and I loved what she said, where she's like, my whole life, I was trying to be different. I just wanted to be different, and I just realized I had to be myself.
Yeah.
And
it's a beautiful message.
An Oscar winner, an Academy Award winner. That's amazing.
That's wonderful. And honestly,
we've talked about the holdovers before, and I've said I didn't think that that was a performance that was.
You mentioned
Oscar,
that.
I was curious when I saw that she was nominated.
Right.
I was like, okay, I was seeing her and all the other people who are nominated in the category. But I do think that, like, it says a lot that she's won. She's literally swept, like,
yes,
all of the awards.
Yes. Like, yeah.
Every award she's been nominated for, she's gotten in this role. And so I think that the role was, like, it was such an important role in the movie. And so, like,
you needed her in
it
because
in that, yeah,
with just Paul Giamatti and the other actor that played the boy that was with him, she kind of provided almost comedic relief, but also like a lot of heart
to
allow those two to come together in the movie to make it what it is. It was a beautiful movie. There's a look at the trailer
right now.
Honestly, this is a movie I would have seen without it being nominated. That's how much I wanted to see it.
It was interesting, and I will say, I went to see this movie not thinking that I was going to go see this movie.
Right.
But I went to go see it, and I was like, okay, this is kind of interesting, and like the plot was interesting. Everything was, it was interesting to follow, so.
Yeah.
You saw
it in theaters?
I did see it in theaters. Yeah. And I will say, I'm going to drop my interview with John Ridley here.
You should, yes. We have it, too.
Well, but yeah, I think we can play it at some point,
I talked to John Ridley about what he thought were his takeaways from this Oscar season, and he was very hesitant to say, oh, this film is going to win, or this person is going to win, but he did say that Paul Giamatti is someone who he thought really deserves the Oscar this year. And he also said that The Holdovers was a really fantastic film.
It was.
But he also said that we had a year this year that really gave us so much good film.
Yes.
Diversity, different topics, just like Killers of the Flower Moon, Anatomy of Fall, American Fiction.
Different. Zone of Interest.
The Holdovers, Zone of Interest.
Hard.
Yeah, there's everything.
That was such a hard movie to watch. I saw it with my parents. It's basically about a family that lives next door to a concentration camp. And you go into the movie thinking it's going to be about Auschwitz.
Yeah.
It's about how the family just went on with their life as if nothing was happening.
Yeah.
That was the point of the movie.
And you could hear the screams in the background.
You can hear everything. Yeah. I mean, I literally have goosebumps thinking about it. Yeah. It just, I left that movie and I looked at my dad and I'm like, I don't know how to feel. And he was like, that's how a lot of German families were.
Yeah.
They had nothing towards these group of people. And I think that's a story we've never seen. We've seen it in Auschwitz. We've seen the Jewish population. We've seen the Nazis. But we've never seen the everyday families that were just there.
Like it was went on.
That went on.
Yeah.
It was a very powerful movie. I know it's not going to win a lot, but it was incredible. It was worthy of the Best Picture.
I'm wondering if we can pull up the John Ridley interview. Larson.
We have that. Yes, we have it.
Do you want to run the John Ridley interview? We've been talking about it a lot. I know you had some sound from that.
Oh, and also don't forget, you guys can win.
The Shirley premiere, which is happening on Thursday. John Ridley is bringing the Shirley premiere, one of only three cities, here to Milwaukee. It premieres. here, and let's go ahead and take a listen to what John told me about the movie.
Representation is really important, and for young people in particular, to see themselves in different spaces, accomplishing, doing things, participating, it's incredibly important. So whether it's in Milwaukee, whether it's nationally, as Shirley's story was, it's important for us to tell those stories and for everybody to witness the fact that we can, you can, anyone can accomplish.
All right, I think there we go.
That was obviously John Milley talking to me about why he wanted to do Shirley. We're taking a look right now at the, I believe these are the Best Picture nominees.
Yep.
And that was just a clip of the holdovers. But John talked to me about why it was important for him to create a movie like Shirley. He said, obviously, Regina King was a big force behind bringing it to the screen, and she really wanted him to be a part of it. And, I mean, she was the first black woman to be elected to Congress, the first black person to seek a major political party's nomination.
For president.
Yeah. Seeing her life played out on the big screen is going to be, I think, really cool. And it's a star-studded cast. Regina King, Terrence Howard, Brian Stokes Mitchell. It's directed by John Ridley.
Yeah.
I mean, it's fantastic.
We might
I really
be talking
can't
about
wait
it
to
next
see
year.
It. I can't wait
yes.
to see it. I can't
yes.
wait to see it.
Yeah. And that's a story, I'm surprised, hasn't been told before.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
Such a paving the way like that, you know?
And that's,
so cool.
I think, what's so special about some directors and some people that advocate for those stories is that they find those ones we haven't heard and they bring it to light, like Killers of the Flower Moon, like, you know, all the other ones that are nominated. It's great that he's able to do this, showcase an actress we love, Regina King, and to make this happen right here.
Yeah.
I mean, how great. And you guys have
Regina
a chance to win
it. King, by the way, like, I mean, I've been a Regina King fan since, like, forever. So, like, I love that. I'm bringing my phones out here so I can share this on Facebook.
Oh, yes. We're still live on Facebook
and
with you guys.
You also talked to Ridley about those tax incentives.
Right.
We have some of that sound, too. We want to talk about that. But he was kind of explaining why that's something Wisconsin could benefit
from. Yeah, absolutely. So, right now, Wisconsin is one of 10 states in the country that does not have film tax credits, and we're only one of 5 states that do not have a statewide film office. And so his point is that we're leaving money on the table because, I used to live in Louisiana for a long time, and Louisiana was like coined the Hollywood of the South.
It was,
because
you
can have so many movies go there and film there, and they would get tax credits.
Right.
And so John Ridley's point is that, hey, if we had tax credits to offer to production studios, we can get a lot of more films filming here.
Right.
TV shows, films. Yeah. And yes, they would get tax credits, but also we'd get the
business.
The
business. Honest, quite frankly.
I think Milwaukee would be a great city to film movies in because it looks like a city, but it's not super busy and overwhelming like you can find in Chicago or New York, where you can close off a whole street to film and it's not going to ruin the whole week for somebody.
Right.
and
we have so many great landmarks that emulate other landmarks, because he was talking about being in Ohio and Dayton, and how you can film at like the Dayton City Hall, and that looked like any city hall anywhere.
Right. Yeah.
Our Milwaukee City Hall, which has been around for like 100 years.
Right, it's gorgeous.
Absolutely.
And the courthouse, and the art museum, like that is such a great background for everything. Headshots.
And we need more than Bridesmaids Milwaukee, where they just showed like the West Dallas apartments that are very iconic. Yeah. You can make any single city if you're a good enough of a filmmaker.
I will say, Bridesmaids was like,
well, I mean,
one of my first, I was like, oh, Milwaukee.
I see you.
See? Yeah,
you know, if you know how to film something a certain way, you can make any city look like another city. Random factoid of the day, they filmed Ninja Turtles from 1990 in North Carolina to make it look like New York, and it looks like New York.
Oh my gosh.
Random quote, random stat, but we do have the best animated short film, War Is Over, inspired by the music of John and Yoko. That is not the one I picked. I picked Letter to a Pig.
I don't think I picked one because I was like, I don't know what any of these are.
I didn't either. You just got to guess. You just got to guess. But you can, I think, some of the live action and animated short films were part of that Marcus movie passport. Yeah. I did miss those. Those
well,
are fun.
I think the Oriental Milwaukee film was doing sort of a passport with all of the animated or the short films so that you could kind of maybe
watch
give up at 3 hours of your day, but you saw 10 movies.
Right, right. That's the beauty of watching those ones. So right now they're just giving their acceptance speech for that. I would say probably next would be actor in a supporting role. I would say that would be the one with Ryan Gosling, Robert De Niro, Sterling K. Brown.
I can't wait to see Ryan
Mark Ruffalo.
Gosling do
it's gonna
I'm
be such
Ken.
A it is. Oh. And he's gonna perform I'm Just Ken, which
I know.
Is like I don't think anybody expected that to be a leading contender with the original song category.
I know. Oh my god.
I think that Billie Eilish is a takeaway.
It's a shoe-in.
I hope that she is.
Yeah, she's a shoe-in.
I am such a Billie Eilish fan and I love her so much.
What
and
are her fans called? Like the
Billies? I don't know. Billies? Breathies? I don't know.
I don't know what
she was giving
I'm
Michael Jackson so vibes Billies. With her outfit this evening. You missed the red carpet.
Oh, I missed that.
She kind of had like a tuxedo vibe, oversized with a hat. It was very Michael Jackson of like 1993, I would say. It was great.
I think
great,
it's best not animated movie
animated.
Right now.
Yeah, or, right now we have Anya.
Animated feature now.
Anya Taylor-Joy and Chris Hemsworth, which I can recognize that voice anywhere.
Yeah.
That deep Australian voice.
We love a deep Australian voice.
Is Elemental Pixar, I'm assuming?
Yes.
They always seem to run away with.
I feel like over the last few years, some of their movies haven't been as, I don't want to say good, but not as impactful.
Yeah.
Boy in the Heron.
The Boy in the Heron.
Yep.
That was a big one. A lot of people really liked The Boy in the Heron.
Yep.
Yeah.
We talked
about
it.
Hi, how are y'all? Y'all look beautiful. I'm taking a look at people who are.
A lot of people
fantastic.
All dressed up. We have our own little red, a sparkly carpet.
Okay, SEUD.
I know, Dwayne Wall is in the back over here.
Dwayne, okay.
I'm so dapper.
Yeah, he does clean up good. Yeah. I love D. Yeah.
D is all suited and booted. So is Larson. Got the little, suspenders.
Yes, I'm trying to. Oh, there it is, the Boy in the Heron. I got that one right.
Yay.
I have to take score.
The tax incentive.
Okay.
Oh.
So what we were just talking about as we take a look at these commercials, we were talking about the tax incentive push. And obviously there is a push right now from state lawmakers and filmmakers and studios to bring tax incentives to Wisconsin.
Yeah.
And so what that means is that if a film comes to Wisconsin, if a television studio comes to Wisconsin, then they would get tax incentives and it would obviously bring them to the state. John Ridley right now is really pushing for Wisconsin to create these tax incentive programs because we're one of only 10 states in the country that doesn't have them. Take a listen to what he had to say to us earlier this week about creating these programs.
We hope that people will watch the film in Wisconsin. We certainly hope that they'll enjoy the film, but we do hope people will see and realize that these kinds of things, films, television, they can happen in Wisconsin. But the only way that they can happen is if there are some tax incentives. And we hope people will take a look and understand that these incentives, that they're retroactive. It's not about putting out money initially and companies walking away. And we hope that there's value. But once people commit to filming in a state, that it can work for both parties. It can work for the studios that are filming, can certainly work for the states that are receiving some of the money and hosting these productions.
And so there is a push right now to bring those tax incentives here. Mm-hmm. Right now there was a bill on the legislature to make that happen this session. It's not going to pass this session, obviously, but lawmakers have promised to bring it back next session. And this is something that is really getting the attention of a lot of people. Mark Ruffalo, who's nominated tonight, has been really pushing for tax incentives in Wisconsin as well. So this is something that we do expect to take off in the future.
Hopefully in the future, absolutely.
Yeah, for sure. We have a special guest joining us right now. Who's this? Ryan Alsop. Yeah. Actually, wait. Oh, wait. I'm looking at your name here, but I know who you are.
I know.
Ryan, we talked. You came into our studio. Oh, my God. Look at you. Looking fantastic.
I love it. It's beautiful. Who are you wearing?
That's okay. Look at Ryan. So Ryan is one of the filmmakers who's being presented throughout the Filmmaker Showcase here at No Studios. It actually wrapped up today, but over the past 4 days, you guys have been participating in this Filmmaker Showcase. Tell me about who you are and the films that you're creating.
Yeah, I'm a local filmmaker, born and raised in Wisconsin, and I've been making a lot of films here and showing them over the years at the Milwaukee Film Fest, at No Studios, and other places that support local film, which are amazing. And I created a film last year and showed it just a few hours ago, and had a great turnout.
Congratulations.
Thank you. What is it called
and what's the premise?
Of course, yeah, it's called Once a Mormon, about two Mormon missionaries that stumble across a very kind of rural hillbilly type of guy, and they learn that he's burying his dead wife in the backyard, and they're in this very precarious situation. There's comedy, there's drama, and it's a fun short.
We also talked to another Wisconsin filmmaker an hour ago or so.
Right.
It's just so cool to talk to you guys, because I think people may, if they're not in the industry, they might not realize that there's people just like you that are doing the thing here with or without tax incentives.
Right.
Yeah. Of course. Yeah, and it's great. I mean, there's a great film community here. There's a lot of us filmmakers who love creating and directing to writing to, you know, every aspect of film production. There's a huge community here, and we all do it for the passion and the love for filmmaking.
How did you come up with your story? I mean, honestly.
Yeah, it was a fun story to come up with, and I was able to attach Richard Karn from Home Improvement and flew him out to Milwaukee.
Stop it.
We filmed it here, and it's actually a premise for a TV show that we're currently pitching out west, so out in LA.
Oh, that's wonderful.
It's a short film, but also a proof of concept, but it was a fun story to write, just a lot of hijinks and craziness.
I love that.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
What are you looking forward to tonight? In terms, do you have anybody who that you're really hoping takes away the Oscar tonight?
I want to know who wins Best Director. I think it's got to be between either Killers of the Flower Moon or Oppenheimer, and I think it's a big powerhouse debate between, you know, Scorsese.
Is that what you look at as an aspiring filmmaker? Like, are you looking in the directing category?
I love directing and I love writing, so I'm looking at directing and the adapted screenplay and original screenplay and seeing, you know, whether it's a new upcoming director or is it going to be Martin Scorsese or is it going to be, you know, a new, you know, up and coming director or writer for that aspect too. So I love seeing those upsets, and you know, it's fun. Yeah.
If you had to pick one.
Oppenheimer. Okay. I am picking Oppenheimer for Best Picture, Best Director.
Okay.
How many days did it take you to watch Oppenheimer?
Oh, it took me about a week. Yeah, it's enough.
What about Killers of the Flower Moon? That's three and a half.
Well, honestly, last night I watched Killers of the Flower Moon, and
Mallory just finished Friday it.
That was your whole Saturday. Yeah, it was the whole weekend. Yeah.
It was two nights. I have an 11-month-old, so it was a little tricky.
She took 3 days.
Took 3 days. An hour a day.
Yeah. I haven't seen a single person that watched it in one sitting.
I still have to watch it.
It's okay. You got time.
But look, we have Octavia Spencer and Melissa McCarthy on stage right now, which are two amazing actresses, obviously. Yeah. What do you think of these two? Would you love to have them in one of your films?
Let's get them to Milwaukee.
Yeah.
I got a role for either of them.
I mean, Octavia she has her own Oscar, and Melissa McCarthy being nominated actually for Bridesmaids.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
I mean.
Wait, was she nominated for Bridesmaids?
Yes. Yes.
Really?
Yes.
So that's one of those situations where Barbie's nominated for Best Picture.
Robert Downey Jr.
How is Melissa McCarthy nominated for a Best Actress Oscar for Bridesmaids.
Yep, Best Supporting.
Because
and then
it's such a fun movie.
It is.
And you just don't think of those movies being nominated. It's like,
I mean, come on,
but
she
I
stole
think
the
there
show.
There is kind of a push that it's like these movies that end up being blockbusters, like Barbie, like some of the Marvel movies that people are like, obviously the general public is loving
it. Yes.
So it's kind of taking a turn where it's like it's not just these hoity-toity critics that get to control what is the best movie of the year.
Right.
You know?
I mean, Robert Downey Jr. up again. He's up for Chaplin. He's been nominated for Tropic Thunder in 2008, and now he's up again for Oppenheimer. Totally different role.
Right. Well, and we were talking, Christopher Nolan has never won an Oscar, which is like mind-blowing because he has
so many
crazy
movies that have been nominated.
Huge
I know.
It's been so long and then it never happened.
Yeah. Iconic.
Yeah.
I can't.
So what do we have here? We have
Scream.
Yeah.
Adapted or is this one
original?
Original. Okay. Original. Thank you. Yeah. You're the expert.
Yeah. My show's gotten a lot of acclaim.
Yes. It was good. I just finished it 2 days ago.
Yeah.
With Bradley Cooper, he actually had his own daughters in the movie. Playing his young daughters in the movie.
That's cute.
I know, I love those little touches.
Yeah.
And who is it? Uma Thurman and I can't think of her name, but she's in Stranger Things. Uma Thurman's daughter was in it. I can't think of her name right now.
Yeah.
She's in Stranger Things. Oh, I can't think of her name. It's going to kill me.
I love, is this Aubrey Plaza?
No, that's Past Lives. That was really good. That was a tough
takes,
movie to
let's
watch.
Let's see who takes the Oscar for Best Original Screenplay.
Anatomy of a Fall. Wow.
Which has gotten a lot of acclaim this what did you think about Anatomy of a Fall?
I missed that one.
Yeah.
Did you miss it?
Half of it's in French. Half of it is in French.
Okay.
But it's got Sandra Hullman in it, who also was in The Zone of Interest.
Yeah.
She's nominated in two movies that are up for Best Picture.
Wow.
I know. And she's German in one and French in another and speaks American in both. It's quite talented.
She's a genius.
I can't believe how do you do that? I love
Well, obviously we've been talking Oppenheimer, probably will sweep a lot of these categories, but what was your favorite movie that you saw that's been nominated this year?
Honestly, it was Oppenheimer, Killers of the Flower Moon. Those are the two ones.
Those are the two big ones.
The story, the production, the talent, the cast, everything, the ensemble, everything all together. They each left a mark. And that's how I love films to...
If you're still thinking about it,
they're lingering after I'm done and after the credits roll, and it's those are the ones.
Yeah. That you are in the theater and you don't look at your watch.
No, exactly.
Except for Killers of the Flower Moon, I was kind of like, oh my gosh.
Well, we've talked. I thought the first half was amazing, and then the second half slowed down tremendously, and I was like, I think we kind of lost the steam, and I don't think it needed to be 3.5 hours.
Yeah, that's what me and my wife talked about. We felt like it could be under three.
Yeah. But it was still great. Don't get me wrong. I'm not telling anybody not to watch it because it's a great
still
and important
amazing.
Story that everyone should
very,
know.
Yes. Yeah. And it's also one that you can't you can skip this part. You can't because every part actually was kind of important to the next part. You can't.
I did
just,
have to go on Wikipedia and go to plot and read it to make sure I understood.
Right. Yes.
Sometimes you just need a little refresher. Yes. Like, is that what I thought happened?
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
And you know, also I think it is nice to have a context, a backstory of stories that aren't typically taught in school. That's not a story that was taught at all.
Ever.
Yeah. So it's actually nice to have that little bit of a background before you're hopping right into it. So you can actually watch it with a movie perspective and not I'm learning history perspective, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's great. Sorry.
No, I love that.
So who do you think, if there's an upset tonight, where is that happening? I know.
Upset.
There has to be one.
I guess for best actor, I like Giamatti, which I don't know if that's an upset or not, but I love
it. Would be.
I don't think he's going to get it, and I think that is the upset.
I
don't think that he's going to get it, but I think a lot of people think that he should get it.
Yeah.
But I don't. But who would it go to?
Cillian Murphy.
I don't think anybody
compares.
You don't make a movie like Oppenheimer with Christopher Nolan.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
A movie like that with the iconic, you know, Oppenheimer. You know, he talks to Einstein. At one point in the movie. Right. I mean, you just know.
When I did talk to John Ridley a couple weeks ago about just his Oscar predictions, he was very apprehensive to give me any type of prediction, but he did say that Paul Giamatti is one of those, he's one of those Hollywood actors who just like deserves it, who has a category of work that is just fantastic. And what he did in The Holdovers was fantastic. And so I think that there's a lot of belief that he should win it.
Yes.
But I don't know. I don't know if he will.
Didn't he win for that wine movie? What was that?
Sideways. I just remember the poster for it.
Yeah.
He was able to, in The Holdovers, create a character that was mean but you liked him, was hard but funny. And there was a part in the movie, it was like right at the end, I'm not giving away any spoilers by saying this, and he was like, oh, and by the way, it's this eye you look at. Like, it was the best
That was something that transcended The Holdovers. That's like what transcends his whole character and his whole life. It's like, wait, where do I look for Paul Giamatti? It's like, here we go.
And he can play He can play a spy. He can play Santa that he did in Fred Claus. Yeah. And he can play this curmudgeon-y old man that just needs a little bit of heart to get through the day. I think that's great. Yeah. So I think we just saw who won
adapted screenplay.
And Larson, who was the winner here? American Fiction. That's who I picked.
Jeffrey Wright winning for American Fiction.
Oh, this has been at the top of my list, and I never had time to see it.
Is fantastic. You've got Sterling K. Brown.
Jeffrey Wright.
You have Erica Alexander from like Living Single.
Yes.
A long time ago. Like, and now she's
Tracy,
like
Tracy. Oh my gosh, I can't think of her name. She's great. She's in Blackish, I think.
Oh, Tracy Ellis Ross.
Thank you.
Tracy Ellis Ross.
She plays his sister in it.
Yeah. So who's accepting this year? This is Cora Jefferson accepting for adapted screenplay of American Fiction. This would be a history-making film if it actually wins Best Picture and if Sterling K. Brown wins for Supporting Actress. It would be the first time that you have the Best Picture and the Supporting Actor, not me, being in the same movie.
Yes. It was a beautiful movie. It was a story I think that a lot of people think about what gets published. The publishing world in books is extremely hard to get into, and it's just a story that Jeffrey Wright just nailed. I mean, he's obviously nominated for actor for a reason. He was great in it. Sterling K. Brown kind of stole the show in this one, I'm not gonna lie, and he's obviously nominated for Best Supporting, so I think that you need to see it. You have to see it. It was worthy. It was definitely worthy. It wasn't one of those Oscar movies that I had to force myself to watch. Yeah. It was one that I actually wanted to see.
That's awesome.
It was great. So we're happy for them that they won this for original screenplay, or adapted screenplay, sorry.
So I mixed those speaking up. Of screenplays, how difficult is it to write a screenplay?
Yes.
Oh, it is so difficult. It is because it's one of the aspects of it is you're alone, and you are in front of a computer most likely, typing. It's very isolating, and then it's very in your mind to create these stories and these characters and these arcs and to have it be, you know, moving or funny or however the theme is. And a lot of revisions.
But oh, absolutely.
Once it's done and once you get it to the screen, I mean, it's one of the most satisfying, rewarding experiences to see this piece of paper that was in your mind and that you've been writing for months or years.
Who edits you? How does that work?
You got to find a lot of good friends who will give you honest feedback.
Answer. I had a question earlier. I was like, a movie like Killers of the Flower Moon, does it start as a 5-hour long screenplay and gets revised, or does it start as like a 2-hour long screenplay and then they add an extra hour in revisions?
Most of the time, it starts way long
and then it gets cut.
Cut and cut, and they say, you got to trim the fat, cut it.
Right to edit.
Yeah, and you got to enter the scene late and you got to leave the scene early.
Jared.
Edit short and you got to end on a
It's your girl.
Moment.
Oh, Billie Eilish is singing.
Okay. I don't mean to cut you off, but we do need to take a moment to take a listen to Billie Eilish. Billie Eilish and her brother Phineas, who's playing on the piano, they're singing What Was I Made For from the Barbie movie. I am such a Billie Eilish stan. You cannot tell me anything. I think Billie Eilish is one of the most prolific artist of our time.
She already has an Oscar.
Like, she already has it.
And she's already won an Oscar for
No Time to Die.
I just think that Billie Eilish is just like, I mean, listen, I
look at how
Billie Eilish, because she's got the breakup albums, and I'm a king of breakup albums.
Well, and her, okay? Like, the range of her music is
so listen, Billie Eilish has got me through some moments, okay? And this is why me and Billie, we right here, because Billie understands.
But it's like, she can sing this, but she can also sing Bad Guy.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, the range is crazy of just the style of music is nuts.
And that's what made her kind of break out. She has this very soft style, but she has range. Yeah. Like, she can belt. And I love that.
And I love the relationship between her and her brother,
who
is her main producer, obviously, Phineas. But, like, he's always nominated alongside her. Because he's the songwriter and the producer on most of her songs, but they're brother and sister, and so like their relationship is just so fantastic. And I don't know
if I could work with my siblings that closely.
Right?
Hitting heads.
Shout out to DJ.
Billie Eilish. Yeah. I love Billie Eilish so much.
Yeah. And see her look?
I love her so much.
It kind of gives me, she had a hat on earlier, but like with the shoes and the blazer, it gave me a Michael Jackson vibe. She's
my favorite. She's definitely my favorite. And I hope that she wins this album, this category. But also, this is a category that has a lot of great artists. Dua Lipa, right? Is
nominated. Not for original song.
No,
maybe.
Okay, well, let's see. Original song.
Flame and Hot.
Wait, Dua Lipa was for the Golden Globe.
I'm just Ken.
So Billie Eilish is up against Ryan Gosling for I'm Just Ken, which is.
I can't wait to watch that.
Maybe, but Billie Eilish should win it. You also have. Who's this? What was the name from Billie Eilish? You have I'm Fire Inside from Flamin' Hot.
That's funny. I appreciate that.
You got I'm Just Ken from the Barbie movie. It Never Went Away from American Symphony. And then Wakazi from A Song for My People from A Ghost from Fire Rain.
Yeah.
I don't want to be super biased, but again.
Yeah, I think she has this one. I really, really do.
Billie
Eilish.
Well, and this is Billie Eilish is walking away with her second Grammy tonight.
Yeah,
I believe
she would be the second, or she'd be the youngest
but she
person
could get a Grammy.
To ever have two Oscars that quickly. So,
she's so
a legend.
Great. She's so great.
She's gonna be known.
There's
a
Greta Gerwig right there. There's Kate McKinnon.
I am surprised that Dua Lipa was not nominated for
Ariana Grande.
I know, I love that song.
Which is a great, it's also
great.
From Barbie too.
And there's her on the red carpet. I wish I had her with her hat, because that made the look. It made the look. Ugh, but there's Billie Eilish, that's
America Ferrera.
Yep, there you go.
Wait, who do we have here? We have,
Catherine O'Hara.
Who's this? Is this?
Is that Michael Keaton?
That is Michael Keaton from Beetlejuice, which comes out this year.
Okay, so wait, time out.
Sorry, I'm all right.
Catherine O'Hara.
I'm having a moment.
Like, let's go all the way back to our childhoods, right? To Home Alone.
Yeah.
But also, her and Schitt's Creek.
I loved that movie.
Yeah. Schitt's Creek is one of my all-time favorite shows.
It's
of
so good.
All-time, period.
Yeah.
Oh, there's your girl. Sorry, another girl.
Oh, wait, time out. Beyonce is on the screen right now. She's in a commercial. Let's all pay homage.
Take a moment.
Let's all pay homage to the queen.
I'm just here to let Jerry know.
It would be disrespectful to speak around her. No, I'm just kidding. But no, Catherine O'Hara, like, from Home Alone to Schitt's Creek, she's done so many dynamic characters. Yeah. Like,
she left her kid at home, but yeah, she plays a wholesome mother from Home Alone. She plays an eccentric artist from Beetlejuice, and then you got her as an actress in Schitt's Creek. I mean, I just don't know. You know, her range, her, and you know, that accent she made up for that show was on the fly. She just tried it out, and it made the whole, her character.
That show is one of the best shows I've ever seen in my life.
And like, Eugene Levy just got his star on the Walk of Fame. Yeah. And Dan wasn't there. He's filming in Bulgaria. I looked it up.
So it's wholesome. It's pure. It is, it gives you everything. Like, are you a fan?
Yes.
Are you a fan? Yes. Okay. Can I share with y'all one of my favorite scenes of life, of TV? One of my favorite scenes of television in life is the scene where they're in the apothecary and Patrick sings to
David,
Tina Turner, Simply the Best.
Yes.
I mean, like, tears falling. I need that to play at my wedding. Like, that is... It doesn't get better than that. It does not get better than that.
I wish that show could have went longer.
Yeah.
But every good show has to stop at the top.
It's good to end at the top.
Absolutely.
Well, on that note, Ryan, we don't want to take away too
much. Yeah, sorry.
Of your
we're just gabbing with you.
But thank you so much for hopping on with us, giving us that sort of local filmmaker perspective. Yeah. It's been so cool to pick your brain on all this.
Of course. Happy to be here.
Yes.
Great.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
See you.
And I do know that Derek Rose and Dario Melendez are in the house. They are standing by. Pretty soon.
But first, the big premiere in Milwaukee. Enter now for your chance to win. Just go to our website, WISN.com. App, enter to win the sweepstakes. It's a premiere celebration. John Ridley's newest film. This is going to
only big cities.
Right? Yeah.
It's only in New York, Milwaukee, and D.C.
That's going to be
That's
so
important.
Cool.
It's here.
Yeah.
Absolutely. We love that. And you're
what
taking a live look right now inside That's one of the watch party sections where you can sit in a beautiful lounge here at No Studios. We are outside of that right now, and we're talking to you guys on Facebook Live, where they have a little sparkly carpet. They have a bar in the back here. You can get a bunch of drinks and hang out with everyone who is also such a movie fan like the rest of us here that are enjoying this day.
Yeah, it's so great that we live in a city that does something like this. You know what I mean? We're so far from Los Angeles. We're in a completely
different
time zone.
Here's Shirley. You can see right there the trailer.
Yeah, and you can be a part of a movie premiere. You can see this movie in Milwaukee next week. Just enter the sweepstakes on our website to win.
Absolutely. And we're also live on Facebook right now. We want you guys to chime in. I even had Mario sending us a message saying American Fiction was amazing and deserves all of the awards. I need Sterling K. Brown to win. I hear you. Sterling K. Brown was good, but he is up against Robert Downey Jr.'s performance from Oppenheimer, which is going to be a tough...
Saying that. Everybody's been saying Robert Downey Jr. is going to take away the Oscar team.
Yes.
Yeah. Who else is Robert Downey up
He's
against?
Up against Robert
Ruffalo,
De Niro,
Mark Ruffalo, Ryan Gosling, and Robert De Niro.
I think it goes to Robert Downey Jr.
I love him so much. Yeah. I love his story. I love his down at the bottom and worked his way back up to, you know, they took a huge risk with him being an Iron Man. The studio didn't want to hire him, but John Favreau was like, you got to do it. And he was Tony Stark. And that literally made the MCU. And there was actually a really good quote. It's one of my favorite quotes that he said, just because you hit rock bottom doesn't mean you have to stay there.
Oh,
it's a beautiful quote. And for anybody that maybe has had a hard time, that is the quote to get you right back. Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Just because you hit rock bottom doesn't mean you have to stay there. I love that. That
and right now we're fantastic. Taking a look here at the trailer from Past Lives about this one was two childhood best friends in Korea. One gets emigrated to the U.S. for a better life, and then she ends up marrying somebody she met at a writing retreat, and then they end up seeing each other again after 20 years, and they're wondering what could have been.
Yeah.
It is
Captain
one of those.
Captain America, Michael Keaton, there you go.
They are.
Both in Beetlejuice, which comes out this year, everyone.
I will say Past Lives, I think that was our producer Larson's favorite movie. He
that
brought
he loved
a lot in the newsroom.
He's not even listening.
I know.
Yeah, I know, that's okay.
Larson
he
loved
that.
Past Lives.
And he loved Maestro.
Larson, did you love Past Lives?
Yeah, he loved that. And Maestro. You loved Maestro. Oh, I love
I love Michael Keaton. I'm taken back to like Jack Frost.
Oh my gosh.
Right? Like Jack Frost.
I'm thinking like Batman, Beetlejuice, Bert. He was nominated for Birdman.
Oh, yes,
Emma Stone was
yes.
nominated for Birdman
I
back
saw Birdman.
In like 2015.
That was
a weird movie. It was weird.
Yeah.
He was in Spider-Man, No Way Home. He played the villain. Just random, I know.
This is for makeup that they are doing the award
So they're
out for
really
right
out of
now,
order
so.
In this, I feel. Usually we already get another big one, I guess you
it's
could say.
It's just crazy to see the time lapses of them like
oh, I know.
Getting all this makeup on and prosthetics.
Oh, yes, that's right. You mentioned that. And there's Poor Things right there, Emma Stone. William Dafoe, if you thought he already was a little scary looking, they added a lot for Willem Dafoe. Loved him in the movie, though. My God. I mean, he was brilliant in Poor Things.
Right,
but...
right.
So here we go with makeup. I think I had
poor
that.
Poor Things won.
I wrote that. Makeup and hairstyling, Poor Things.
I mean, Poor Things, makeup and hairstyling. I mean,
did you
like,
see it?
That was fantastic.
It was so
good. I didn't even see the movie, but like, just, yeah. I saw
yes.
everything.
Yeah.
And, like,
right, right. That's all you had
yeah,
to
that was,
right.
like,
I would love to know
to
how long.
Yeah.
Can you imagine? I think I read somewhere that like Jim Carrey for The Grinch had to sit in the chair for like 16 hours or some ridiculous amount. It's like, what do you do? Like, what do you do? You would go mad. Just is that your work day?
I know.
Do you go to
and
sleep
then imagine
like
if you had like an itchy eyebrow.
Oh
You're
my
like,
gosh.
Oh, I can't.
That would drive me mad. I don't think I could do that. I don't know how the guys do it here, but yes.
Yeah. Pretty cool though. And where do they put their Oscar now? Do you think they already have a spot cleared out on a shelf somewhere?
I hate it when the actors or whoever wins the awards, I hate it when they're like, oh yeah, it's in my bathroom. It's like, what do you mean?
I know.
How can you do that? How can you say that?
I want to see
it. Where is your Oscar? Is it like, where are you going to put your Oscar if you get an Oscar?
Like, I would have to have like a mantle or something. Yeah. Like it's got to be like, it would have its own light.
I would do like a cutout of my living room, just like punch it out
Listen,
with its own.
I got one Emmy in my life, and that is prominent in my living
room.
Okay?
Yes.
It is prominent on the shelf.
Yeah. It's as it should be. It requires its own soundtrack.
Yes.
Maybe
yes,
like like an illuminated version of yourself, like they did with Tupac, where you have your speech.
Sure,
so you only need the GOT for the ego.
Yeah.
You're
I
almost there.
The ego. Yeah. I would need the ego. I got the T.
No, you got the E.
I got the E. I
need the
God. I need the God.
You gotta get the God.
I gotta get the God.
Well, there's a lot of filmmakers here. You have an opportunity to, you know.
Rub elbows.
Yeah.
Yep.
You could be acting.
I'm trying to get John Ridley to do a biopic on Beyonce.
No. Beyonce, that'd be amazing.
Right?
He said that he would. I did ask him in his in our interview. I asked him what he's working on. He says, you know what, like, I'm trying to, like, wind it down, is basically what he said. I'm trying to wind it down. And I was like, well, you need to do a biopic on Beyonce, and that would be the moment when you.
So now we're looking at production design. Larson just wrote us a message. Production design, we have here Barbie, Killers of the Flower Moon, Napoleon, which had,
Joaquin Phoenix, thank you.
Oppenheimer, and Poor Things. I actually thought Barbie because most of the production was actually real sets, which is rare.
And it was really good.
Poor Things, they did create a lot of their sets, but a lot of it was CG, like the backgrounds and stuff. But yes, Poor Things. So that would be
Have we seen Oppenheimer?
It hasn't.
Poor Things. And
Oppenheimer has not won anything just yet.
One and done movies.
Wow. I'm actually a little surprised, quite frankly. I thought Barbie
the night is young.
There's still plenty. And we're still live on Facebook right now. Oh, I love your guys' comment. Oh, we got a Beetlejuice reunion. See, that's what I was talking about, Alex. Donovan, thank you for chiming in there. they specifically tie people together when they have a movie coming out. They do that on purpose. That's how they do it. But
yeah.
I wonder what's next. I wish we had like a rundown of like what comes up next so we could feature it a little bit more here, but
you're looking at the trailer for Poor Things right now, which just won for production design. So, big night for Poor Things already. We've had a couple.
That has been, yes. How many for Poor Things? I think they've won two so far. Yeah, Poor Things has won two. Holdovers won. Oppenheimer, none yet, which is interesting. And you can see some of that makeup a little bit up close, like we saw here in the trailer, as we had mentioned there. So I wonder how you go about making a conscious choice to make someone look like that.
Yeah.
I mean, quite frankly.
Yeah, and Poor Things is also still nominated for costume design, so they could be winning again coming up very soon. So.
Yes, absolutely. So and Larson, who do we have for Best Picture nominees? Do you want to put them up on the screen? And I think we're going to be switching a little bit here. Daria, you guys coming up here? I think they're just about time.
Yeah. Changing of the guards.
Changing of the guards.
I think you should go another half an hour.
Because we're going to be live for you guys on 12 News this morning.
Best moment for the Oscar history.
Oh, I like that.
That was a streaker.
Yeah, oh, yes, streaker. In the 70s. That was kind of a thing.
Goodness.
That was a little bit.
We were here for 2 years ago when there was the best Oscars moment.
The slap heard around the world.
I was
Lindsey
with,
was here.
I
like,
was with Derek and.
We had just left.
Derek and Matt Smith. Yes. And I was just like, oh my gosh, this is happening. Oh, there's John Cena. I think he's going to try to streak.
Is John Cena naked?
Yes. I doubt he's really naked, but I think they're pretending for the streak moment here.
It's crazy to see him with long hair, John Cena. Like, because he had a buzz
for so
long. John
Cena followed me on Twitter.
What? No, he didn't.
Or X. He did.
Unfollow.
But I think he's been following a lot of like reporters randomly. I don't think he realizes he's following me.
That's
like,
okay. Doesn't matter if it was a mistake. So what? Okay.
But I feel like he's the one kind of person that follows and then gets like 10,000 followers from that
follow, and
then he unfollows everybody.
Right.
Oh, that's a mean tactic. I don't like it. I don't like that at all. I'm enjoying watching this interact. Maybe, I don't know, I'm a little nervous.
I wish I could hear it. It's.
I can kind of hear it a little bit. Hello.
Yikes.
That was my close-up. Hello, how we doing?
But he did just hand him a card that says costume design, so
Oh my.
Well, listen, my commentary stops right now.
Well, Well, if you're just tuning in, they're making fun of a 1974 nude streaker at the Academy Awards, so.
I have nothing to say.
Oh, no. Oh, buddy. I mean, you know what?
Not touching that one. Not touching that
one. He's cut. He's wearing Birkenstocks.
I'm sure he is.
Sorry, the shoe choice is what's throwing me off. Birkenstocks.
Oh, Birkenstocks.
Sure, Jordan. Nope.
Oh, my goodness.
So we wow. Got
our
moment for the night.
Yeah.
Wow. That's a moment. What are we doing this
What category is this? Right, what category is this?
Is this costume design? Costume design. Okay. Man, we're just going through all of them here. All right, I picked Barbie, but I don't know if
I'm at a loss for words after that.
I am.
No, costume design? I think he was going to go to Poor Things.
Probably, yeah. You're probably right, because they made conscious decisions.
Yeah.
You got a little excited.
That was Dario Melendez, everyone.
Poor things.
Poor Things, that's the third down for Poor Things. Wow.
How exciting.
Oh, I picked the wrong one, my bad.
That is pretty cool. Yeah, so Holly Waddington of Poor Things just is taking that away in design.
It's one of those movies that like are so bizarre, and I feel like it's such a Oscar contender, mm-hmm. and it's why I really want to see it. I have not seen it yet, but like yeah. I really want to see it. Poor Things, because like it's strange, it's bizarre.
Strange and bizarre is the perfect way, and there is a lot of nudity.
Yeah,
there's a lot. Yeah.
But the cast is also so great. So,
they
like,
are
you,
good.
You believe in that because of that. You believe in that. The greatest of them.
Yeah, I haven't seen Poor Things. That was on my list, but was that a long one? How long was that?
No, that I feel like maybe a 2-hour, if that.
I'm like, what happened to a 90-minute movie?
Because you're trying to figure out.
Nothing's 90 minutes anymore.
Yeah, nothing. I think like Anatomy of a Fall was like that, and then that movie just ended, and
that
I was like,
that used to be the standard.
I know. What happened? I don't know what happened to that. So, yes. So right now they're accepting the award there. So that's Poor Things. That's 3 there. Oppenheimer still is. Oh, for, I don't know, at least 3 or 4 at this point.
Uh-oh.
I'm looking here.
Might Who knows? Be some... Maybe that's a sign of the night. We'll see what happens.
It might be. It's been like this so far. So
yeah.
We have our second shift standing by. I can see them there with the microphones.
Yeah, they're getting
I think
ready
Dario
to do some
is going
things
in the...
inside the theater yep. is what we've been told. So that's going to be a really great way to shake things up. You'll see people that are inside the watch party sitting in those comfy chairs.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so...
be good. Oh, is John Cena clothed though? It looked like
he's got a wrap. He's got a wrap on.
He's got a robe.
He did. It looked like he had a toga. I think it was like from Animal House over here.
They're like, here's a snuggie.
Here's a snuggie. You know what? You gotta clip that. I think I would take that at this point. I want to see that again, or just because it was funny.
I know. Let's zoom out.
She actually emulates the character of Bella. With her outfit choice, with the big puffy sleeves. I really love that. Mindy Haddington. Yeah, there's Jesse walking away with a pink dress. Hey, Rock. Hello. Is that Bad Bunny?
The Rock Johnson.
Is that Bad Bunny?
Yes, it is. Bad Bunny.
There's Jesse.
Oh, my goodness. All right, guys.
Bad Bunny. Love that.
That wraps up our time here on the Oscars live show. It's now going to be taken over. Dario Melendez is live inside one of the theaters here at No Studios. He is going to be giving you an inside look at the watch party.
Yeah, and Derek Rose is coming up after that. And I'm telling you, I'm looking at Derek Rose right now. He's got a blazer that I want. So
it does look
I thought everyone mentions how your wardrobe is.
I mean, everybody always asks that. And listen. I have a very small closet, but I want Derek Rose's blazer right
That's
now.
That's a great blazer, Derek.
It's a good blazer.
We love it. We love it.
Well, don't forget, we will be on air tomorrow morning starting at 4:30.
On 12 News this morning with the reactions, the big winners, the losers. Is it going to be Oppenheimer? Is it Poor Things? Killers of the Flower Moon?
We'll find out.
But Dario and Derek are going to be here to get you through the rest of the night.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, guys.
Dario, take it away.
Thanks, Jaren. I'm glad you guys have calmed down since the John Cena incident. I'm inside the private studio here at No Studios. Nice little watch party. You guys all excited? Woo! I feel like I remember you guys from last year. Maybe? No? You have that face. You're an actor. But I do remember these lovely ladies from last year. Pam was here last year, and Ursula, if you know Veep, was a Veep 100, right?
Yeah.
Famous Milwaukee DJ here in the great Cream City. But Pam, last year we wanted to do an interview. You weren't as prepared, but you did your homework this year.
This year I did my homework, definitely. And I have to say that I spent the whole weekend viewing films and, like, crying.
Which ones got you crying?
Oh, my God. Killer of the Flower Moon, The Color Purple. They were also... It's all about the human spirit and about being kind to people. And this is a time when we need to have enlightenment into the history of America and what has happened with in the past, but also to embrace being kind and being loving. And I think that was a message I saw in a lot of the movies, but also with Lily Gladstone. She said very few words, but it was her silence that was impactful.
Yeah. Ursula, did you do your homework?
You know what? I really didn't do a lot of homework, but I'm here for it all. The fashion, the networking, who's nominated, why they were nominated, the great speeches. I'm here for it all, just to take it all in.
What's been your favorite speech so far?
The first one.
From Divine?
Yes, it was so emotional. She just the whole empowerment that she had, not thinking that she was good enough. And it's so many women that have experienced that. But for her to realize that, yes, I am good enough. Yes, I am here. And I've made it. That was just great and really empowering for all women all over the world.
Yeah, Divine Joy Randolph winning for a Best Supporting Actor for her role, actress, I should say, for her role in The Holdovers. You said you did your homework.
Yeah.
Which movie is taking home Best Picture?
Well, I know that they're saying Oppenheimer, but I have to say I did love Killer of the Flower Moon. I thought it was cinematic. I really hated, for the first time, Leo DiCaprio. I really, like, was resentful how just a jerk he was. So
well, that means he did a good job, right?
Yeah, I know. That's why I was surprised he wasn't nominated, but, you know, c'est la vie. But, yeah, it was, I loved that movie. I thought it was really beautiful and really, really, it wasn't a happy story, but what can I say?
Yeah, I really love The Holdovers. And before I let you ladies go, Ursula, you mentioned fashion as well. Obviously, you know something about fashion.
That's funny you said that. When I was realizing that I was invited, I was like, what am I going to wear? What do they normally wear? And I said, you know what, I'm getting my little Erica.
You got this later on the house?
Get my little Erica Badu on and come in here and take it from there. Next year, maybe I'll do something different.
Who's worn it the best so far?
What do you mean by that?
Of any of the winners, any of the red carpet that you've seen, have you seen anything yet?
We saw some of it, but we were busy trying to hobnob and trying to learn more about the movies and who's up for being nominated.
We're working in studios. Hello.
But I love a lot of the long gowns that some of the women were wearing.
Oh, nice.
I was really digging
that. Yeah, let's take a look, Jason.
I mean, we got some beautiful people here. When we pan the room, great outfits. You're right, Ursula. What are we?
Milwaukee represented.
Yeah.
I mean, Ursula, you hit the nail on the head. We don't need to worry about the actresses and actors. We got some star-studded people here at No Studios.
Yeah, I love the bling. That's the thing. All the women love the bling. You know, the lady in the front's got her gray on with the bling. You see the brown in the second row with the bling.
I literally said that to my son the other day, and he had no idea what bling was. I'm like, oh, man, I got to introduce you to some Birdman.
Yeah, that's all Hollywood style.
But I do like your jacket there.
You got it going on.
You're styling, so
I
got to let my kid know I still got some drip. I got my J's on. We're all good.
That's
right. Well, Pam and Ursula, thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of our Oscar watch party here at No Studios. Derek going to be joining you in just a second.
makeup and hairstyling, original score, and costume design.
I have no idea. Check, check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can tell you it is...
2.
2? Mike, 2.
Thank you. So you said this is what Larson's going to be sending us stuff here.
Okay.
I'm going to make sure my volume is not on this.
What do I do with my phone?
All right, great.
Hey, Rob, can you hand me my phone? It's on that chair. Thank you.
You guys are live.
Appreciate it.
We're live? I don't believe you. I don't believe you.
Okay, so what have you guys missed since we've been gone? Original score, which are poor things, obviously.
We are live. They weren't joking when they said you're on. Well, thank you, Sean. That's what they're supposed to do.
Best international film went to Zone of Interest. Very good movie. It's very like Schindler's List-ish.
Yeah.
Where you have a Nazi commander, an Auschwitz camp commander, trying to live a normal life outside of a concentration camp.
Literally outside of a concentration camp.
Yeah, that was the whole the shtick theme of the movie. And I think last year was another German film. It was All Quiet on the Western Front.
Yes.
Which is another great film.
I think I did see that one.
Yeah.
This year, not so much. Did not get as many in as I wanted to.
Yeah, no. I mean,
but I did see some of the Best Picture nominees. And Oppenheimer.
I think Oppenheimer's going to probably run away with it, even though they haven't won.
Well, what's surprising, yet. They're 0-4 right now.
Well, it's just Poorer Things was so, and I think Lindsey and Mallory hit the nail on the head. It was so weird and awkward.
Mm-hmm.
The set design was crazy, which kind of like puts it in the category of all those other.
Yep. The makeup. What is this one?
Oh,
this one?
Oh no, they were just presenting.
Oh.
It puts it in the category of like, you know, the Lord of the Rings movies and the Star Wars, because it was so out there. Mm-hmm. And just weird. So it doesn't surprise me, like hair and makeup, score,
that it'll
set
get
design,
those
that it
things
got those wins
because of the way it was presented.
So what, that's 4 wins for 4 things?
That looks like 4, yeah. Production design,
3, and
makeup and hairstyling, original score, and costume design.
Score, yep. So yeah, 4 wins so far. So poor things is really starting
is
to
the one that's
things.
Quote unquote sweeping,
yeah,
if
right.
you will. And
I was actually surprised when we were talking about makeup and hair. That's the one I missed.
Makeup and hairstyling.
I thought.
Oh, that's one. Okay.
Yeah. So Poor Things, obviously. It makes sense, but I really love Maestro's makeup and hair. Did you get to
that's
watch?
The one I did want to see that I haven't gotten
with Bradley
to
Cooper.
With Bradley Cooper.
Because they just age him. It was very Citizen Kane, mm-hmm. where, you know, Citizen Kane, I'm sure you watched.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like what every film class has to do, the low angles, the high angles, to like, you're in power, so you're bigger than
right.
it's even, then you're dying, so you're at a lower angle. That's really what that was. And Bradley Cooper was phenomenal.
Yeah. The things I kept reading about... when it came to the makeup was the prosthetic nose for Bradley Cooper.
Yeah.
That's the thing I kept reading.
For Leonard Bernstein. Lenny Bernstein. But again, we're going to have some more great guests coming our way. Mary Hansen's going to be joining us.
Oh, we've got a guest
Hansen's
coming up.
Getting
set
right now.
What you're looking at, I believe, is inside the John Ridley screening room here at No Studios, the John and Terry Ridley screening room. So we got a lot of folks here. They do this event every year, and it's really a great event to have folks come here to No Studios to see. And right there, we also want to mention you have a chance celebration and VIP reception for Shirley. That is John Ridley's film that is going to be premiering soon. So we want to make sure our viewers know that. For your chance to win, you don't have to enter anything. It doesn't cost you anything. You can get a chance to get tickets to that free screening. I'm gonna pull this up. I'm just gonna pull up the stream.
So now we're back in. Obviously, you can see we've added another lovely person to our cast right now. Mary Hansen joining us. Mary, thanks so much. Look, first off, tell the viewing audience a little bit about yourself.
All right, so I'm Mary. I'm a local artist and filmmaker. I'm not originally from Milwaukee, but I had moved here a couple months ago, and it's been pretty cool.
Where are you originally from?
Kenosha.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so not far.
You're right down the road.
Yeah, pretty much.
You're one of us.
Your first time here at No Studios?
Yeah, actually, my first time here at No
Studios. What do you think about it?
It's been great so far. I had a short film come out, I think last year or earlier. Yeah, last year. Mm-hmm. And
what's the name of it?
It's called Is There a Strategy to Peeling an Orange?
That's fun. What was it about? Peeling an orange?
No, I'm
But it's an experimental film, and it's about like four friends. It all takes place in one room, and it's kind of about like their descent into like madness when it comes to like love and relationships and that sort of thing.
Well, we've already had animated short film announced. War is Over, inspired by the music of John and Yoko. Did you get to see any of these animated short films?
I have not. That sounds really cool, though.
Yeah, no, I looked. I mean, I saw 95 Senses, Our Uniform. Yeah, War is Over is cool. What goes into making a short film? Because I feel like people would think, oh, yeah, a short film, that's definitely the way I want to do it, but I feel like there needs to be so much impact in the short amount of time you have.
Definitely. No, absolutely. Well, this was my first time doing it, and I kind of just went about it in a way where it was something that I was interested in and I cared about, and then I realized that a lot more goes into making a short film than I ever thought. Like, yeah. There's so many like different cogs to the machine that makes it run, more than you really think about as you're planning that sort of thing.
What was it that got you into filmmaking?
My friends, pretty much. My friend Genevieve helped me.
Is Genevieve here?
She is.
Shout out Genevieve.
Shout out Genevieve. She made a short film not too long ago, and I helped with the cinematography for it.
Very cool.
What was that movie called?
It's called O-Rats.
Right, got to put the names out of every film out there, especially for our local filmmakers.
Definitely. I did the cinematography for that because originally I was just a photographer, and then she helped me branch out into cinematography, and then I realized on the set that this was something that I was really interested in, and that was a lot of fun, and I wanted to do it again.
You got bit by the bug.
I did, yeah, absolutely.
That's awesome. You mentioned some of the challenges that went into making a short film. Which kind of caught you by surprise?
Honestly, getting scheduling a ton of people to be in one place at one time is probably the hardest thing, especially like at this age, people have jobs, they have things that they're doing. And so really just working around everybody's work schedules was really hard. It was really tough to pick a day or a weekend to film it. It was filmed in like 3 days.
To get everybody on the same page, yeah.
Yeah.
They are doing, presenting for Best Supporting Actor right now.
And I love what they're doing now, where they bring up past Best Supporting Actors.
Yes.
Did you watch any of these movies for Best Supporting Actor?
I'll have to hear
best
it.
Best Supporting Actor role.
Sterling Brown in American Fiction.
Oh, yeah. Sterling Brown in American Fiction. Robert Downey Jr. in Oppenheimer. Robert De Niro, Killer of the Flower Moons. Ryan Gosling in Barbie. And Ruffalo in Poor Things. Mm-hmm.
Wow, I haven't seen these movies, but I do admire the actors a lot.
Watching these movies, I feel bad for anybody who has to like judge them, because there wasn't one role that was weak.
Definitely.
Like everybody was so
and everybody was so strong in their respective roles. That's what makes these so interesting to see who wins.
Yeah. Nice. That's great. Yeah, Robert Downey Jr. and Oppenheimer playing Strauss was great. He was really good. Oh, yeah, those two played together in Iron Man. He was, he was Hammer. So he was like the bad guy to Robert Downey Jr. He was the jealous one. Sorry, I'm a little bit of a Marvel movie dork.
Yes.
I've seen all of them. I've seen most of them.
Yeah. Yeah, Justin Hammer. When you were making your film, did you use your friends as actors and actresses, or did you have to like have a casting call?
I did both, actually. Yep, mm-hmm. I had a casting call for half of them, and then met friends through friends.
Oh, cool.
For the rest of them, yeah, it was cool. Actually a lot of fun. It was really cool to. Nice to do the casting call to meet new people outsourced that way.
Mm-hmm. Is it hard being the boss?
Yes.
Why so?
I think especially when you work with your friends, you don't, you know that you have to do things, you have to get things done, but they're your buddies, you know, you don't want
right.
to be too hard on them.
You don't
want
to be the heavy,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, you want to still make sure that it's a fun thing that people are doing.
Because mm-hmm. you have a vision in mind, and you want to execute that vision the way it needs to be, so everybody's got to make sure they're in line with the vision.
Definitely.
He just had a little slip up when he was talking to Robert De Niro. He's like, Oscar winning, I mean, Oscar
nominated.
So is that a little little tease?
And who are your friends that you have here with you? You can shout everybody out.
These are my friends. This is Nat. They're a big help for Is There a Strategy? Mm-hmm. And Genevieve, who was my co-director. And then my best friend Ash is here, and they helped with set design, and it was so much fun. They were great. Everyone here was really great.
So what is the outlook for you? What's the plan for you in filmmaking? What's next?
I do have another short film that I want to do closer to the end of summer. That's a little bit based on my life, actually. It's like a passion project of mine. Mm-hmm. I don't know for sure if film is what I want to do like in the very long run, but I know that I'm having fun right now doing it
yeah.
and telling stories right now. And that's, I think, the next one for me.
Okay. Excellent.
So if not filmmaking, what would be next?
I just applied to go back to college, actually.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, for facilities maintenance. I do have a lot of fun doing hard work projects and stuff.
Okay.
My dad is a maintenance man, and I think it'd be really cool to learn how to do basic maintenance like plumbing and electrical
for sure.
and stuff. Yeah, I think that'd be really cool
for
me.
Where have you applied?
Gateway in Kenosha.
Cool.
Okay. In Kenosha.
Yeah.
Kenosha.
Yeah.
I loved when you said, I'm not from here. I'm from Kenosha. What are you talking about? You're one of us.
I've had like the conversation with people like what constitutes Milwaukee. Like, is West Allis Milwaukee? Is Brookfield Milwaukee?
I see.
Like, there's like a barrier, I guess, that I don't know about yet.
Here we go. Oscar for Best Supporting Actor.
Robert Downey Jr.
Yep. Wow. That was... So this is when
Oppenheimer
is going to start taking over.
Yep.
Robert Downey Jr. as Strauss as the heel, the good guy turned heel, was phenomenal.
He was nominated for
Chaplin,
and I didn't know he was nominated
for Tropic
Thunder.
His role, and you can't make Tropic Thunder now. Like, you could not make Tropic Thunder in 2023. It's hilarious we mentioned that because I was talking to my son about this today.
Uh-huh.
Because I'm like, look, we need to watch Tropic Thunder. Robert Downey Jr. was phenomenal in it, mm-hmm. but you can't make that movie in 2023. And I think he even talked about it. He's like, hey, you might get canceled if you do this. I got to tone this down.
Very quickly.
But I'm just glad people didn't take that movie too out of context.
Right, right. And Larson, is this his first Oscar?
I believe so, yes.
We think this is Robert Downey Jr.'s first Oscar, third nomination overall.
And look, I mean, Robert Downey Jr. is so deserving, but Robert De Niro was so good in Killer of the Flower Moon as another heel.
Yes, yes.
Obviously based on a true story about how people took advantage of the Osage in Missouri,
mm-hmm.
and he was one of them. It's like, oh, I'm your best friend, but no, I'm not your best friend. I want all your money.
Yeah.
But yeah, Robert Downey Jr. is great. And you said you're a Marvel dork. This is why Robert Downey Jr. killed himself off in the Marvel movies, because he wanted to do more serious roles.
Films that are outside
of
typecast.
He didn't want to be typecast. And even though, I mean, he's the godfather of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Yeah.
He wanted out to try newer and more challenging things, which I think a lot of mm-hmm. us in our profession, like you even talked about, you want to try some new, more challenging things. And he was just rewarded for it. Good for him. Really good for him.
He gambled on himself. That's what you got to do.
Very cool. So that's the first one for Oppenheimer. I'm guessing there's, I'm guessing Murphy's gonna win. I would think they win for Best Picture as well.
I think they're gonna win
Poor Things is 1-4 already.
Yeah.
But for what they've won. So if you had to, are you working on another short film, you said?
Yep.
Okay. What did you learn from making your first one that you want to carry over to your second one to make it a little easier, or even what did you do in your first one that you wish, wish you could have done that a little different?
Mm-hmm. I definitely think that with this next short film, I'm going to take my time a bit more. Mm. I said earlier this was filmed in 3 days, a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, two nights and one daytime, and it was a lot to fit into one weekend.
Into an entire weekend, right.
Yeah. Plus, I had written the script and then filmed it all like in the same summer, so I think with this one, I'd started writing the script a while ago.
How long did that take you, the script writing itself?
So this next script is going to be more visually based, so it didn't take me as long, and I have been planning it over the years already, so
yeah.
It was pretty easy to write this script, but I'm definitely going to take my time when it comes to planning for the visuals that are going to be in it, and making it look realistic, and making it look nice, and choosing a crew as well.
Yeah, I think the crew is probably the most important part, right?
Definitely.
Yeah. Can't make a film without them.
Yeah, right?
What was it, peeling an orange?
Yeah, is there a strategy?
Is there a strategy to peeling an orange? Well, what did you come up with? What was your strategy?
You just gotta stab it.
Just dive into it?
Just dive into it.
Stab it and start peeling.
My wife can peel the entire thing off, like the entire skin off
in
one piece.
No.
Like, when I try to peel an orange, it is a Picasso. It's all over the place. That's actually really interesting. I've never thought of a strategy to peeling an orange.
I feel like there is a strategy. I just don't know it.
Yeah.
So what was the strategy in the short film?
That was, to cut it open pretty much is the
just cut straight
way.
Through?
Yeah, cut straight through.
Nice.
You got to watch it to understand.
I do have to watch. Well, where can we watch it?
It's on Vimeo now. For free to the public online.
There we go.
Yeah.
I like it. Okay.
Strategy
Vimeo,
how to
peel
orange.
An orange. And what is your next short film going to be on? Or can you not divulge that?
I guess I don't know yet. I'll probably do the same thing that I did this. Maybe it'll be on Vimeo at some point next year.
Mm-hmm. How to eat an apple? I mean, that's actually a good one. Like, how to bite into an apple. How do you do that?
Yeah.
Like, do you start in the middle, or do you go top or bottom? Or how to eat a pizza slice?
Oh.
That's always... I see people that go, like, from the crust.
Yeah.
That'll get...
There's ways to do it, and there's ways not to do it.
Right. Well, Mary, thank you so much for joining us here this evening. Hope you all enjoy. Do enjoy the night.
Thank you so much, you guys as well.
Thanks so much.
All right, we want to talk about our sweepstakes, Dario?
Yeah, I would love to talk about our sweepstakes. It's our Shirley sweepstakes. You have a chance to win a VIP reception. Just go to WISN.com. Awesome event to get into, a premium celebration and a VIP reception for the sweepstakes of Shirley at No Studios. To everybody watching us at home.
Yes.
Friends, foes, fellow countrymen. But WISN.com/Shirley, head over there now to vote to win that VIP premium celebration reception.
I know you and I this week were talking about the Best Picture nominees. Which ones did you actually get through?
A majority of them. So, down to it so I don't forget them. Just finished American Fiction, which was phenomenal. Mm-hmm. This is what I was talking about. Like, there were so many, and I never used to be a Oscar movie guy.
Right.
Like, you give me Marvel movies, you give me Star Wars, you give me comedies and action. That's what I want. I want
you'd
to be entertained.
You watch the stuff that you're entertained
exactly.
by.
Exactly. Mainly. But they were good. Like, look, Holdovers was awesome.
It was amazing.
Maestro, I was not expecting to be good, mm-hmm. but Bradley Cooper was so good in it. Poor Things was the weirdest damn movie I've ever seen. I don't even like it. It's
my wife watched that this afternoon.
Frankenstein
and
porn. That's what it is. I think we could say that on Facebook Live.
It's the internet.
Sure, anything goes on the internet. Zone of Interest was really interesting. I love history, so the thought of the juxtaposition of, oh, I'm going to raise this amazing family in this beautiful home in the white picket fence next
but
to Auschwitz.
But then what's next door?
Yeah. Barbie, not the audience for, but it was very entertaining.
Uh-huh.
But Holdover and Killers of the Flower Moon was great. I loved Holdovers. I love Paul Giamatti.
That was the first one out of the list that I watched, and I was glad that was the first one.
Oh,
you and
twins.
I were talking about.
Look at this, twins.
That's a throwback.
I love it.
Arnold and Danny. What are they presenting?
Oh, I forgot that. Yeah, obviously they were in the movies Twins together, but they were both Batman characters. You had Mr. Freeze, which was,
oh, I forgot.
Which was Arnold Schwarzenegger, and you had the Penguin, which was Danny DeVito.
I was like, when was Arnold in Batman? That's right, it was Mr. Freeze.
With the George Clooney Batman?
That's
no
what
remembers.
It was. Yeah, that's
Batman
why I don't remember.
Yeah.
And then Danny DeVito, what, the original Penguin?
Yeah, with Michael Keaton.
Uh-huh. I remember when that film came out.
It was so good.
How?
Oh, look, there's Michael Keaton. Good job, Danny. I love how they can just go in and out of character from 20, 30
years ago. Right in.
So this is for best visual effects.
Best visual effects.
So I wanted to watch this movie, but there were so many going on that I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
I also wanted to watch Godzilla Minus One, and I didn't get to watch it.
Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3.
Okay, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 I've seen. That was phenomenal. I mean, this was so good. This. The problem is I haven't seen the other two.
The other two, right.
Because I heard Godzilla Minus One was great. Oh, but so was Mission Impossible Reckoning Part 1.
Reckoning. I have not seen that.
Oh,
I don't
my
know
gosh.
Why.
Look, and I say this about Leonardo DiCaprio as well. I'm not a... Napoleon... I would hate to be the people voting on this stuff. Because Napoleon was awesome as well. I think Guardians or Godzilla.
Oscar goes to...
Yeah.
Godzilla.
I mean, from everything, and this is one of the things on my to-do
Godzilla
to watch
minus
list,
one.
I've heard nothing but amazing things
about Godzilla
minus
one.
And it's not part of this Godzilla King Kong legendary family that's going on right mm-hmm. now, that they have to keep cranking out movie after movie after
right.
movie. Surprise
so I got to add that one to the list, too.
Yeah, I mean, I would have had to call into work sick to watch all of these.
Seriously.
All of these
to
ones.
To get them all.
Yeah. So let's get that one checked off. Godzilla Minus One. Good for them. Oh, he brought the Godzilla toy up there, too.
That's awesome. I love these moments.
Yeah. This is cool.
Yeah. Oh, no, not the music.
Yeah, you get
this is the
off.
First that's... Godzilla film to be nominated and to win an Academy Award.
And again,
Award.
Because this is a Godzilla film that's not part of the Legendary family. So Legendary films as King Kong and Godzilla.
Right.
And that's why you get King Kong times Godzilla, and they're all teaming up. It's a little more cartoonish,
right.
which is fun. That was supposed to be like an
this
actual motion
different.
Picture.
Okay.
But, I mean, just look at the movies they beat out. In, oh, here we go.
Okay. Film editing. Is Oppenheimer okay, nominated
so,
in this
yep.
one?
So, film editing, Anatomy of the Fall, The Holdovers, Killer of the Flower Moons,
Oppenheimer,
and Poor
Things. So, of these, I saw Anatomy of the Fall, Holdovers, Killer of the Flower Moon, and Oppenheimer.
So, this is
okay.
this is going to be Poor Things.
You think? Right? I haven't seen that one. Based on what you're saying, Poor Things, and I would
it's
go just, with Oppenheimer also.
Yeah, it's
potentially.
Either Oppenheimer or Poor Things, but the way it's going, it feels like Poor Things is taking
be,
yeah. all of, like
the technical
yeah,
kind
exactly,
of
yeah.
categories.
Now I'm second guessing myself.
Oppenheimer.
Well, when he said pronounce it better than I did, I was like, oh, it's Oppenheimer.
Right. How did Arnold pronounce
now,
it?
Now Oppenheimer's making its run. It's next two of the last three categories, Best Supporting Actor with Robert Downey Jr., and then Oppenheimer.
It's like it's funny because Jaron was complimenting me on this blazer. And I said I hadn't worn it since Kentucky Derby I went to, but Oppenheimer, this is almost like a Kentucky Derby race where
yes.
it starts out, people out of the gate, and then...
Well, it was
you
kind
might
of
be
all
behind.
Over the place at
yeah.
first. Like, I was surprised for adapted screenplay, it was American Fiction.
Right.
I thought Oppenheimer or Poor Things would have won.
Won that
original
yep.
screenplay, I thought Maestro would have won.
Mm-hmm.
And then Anatomy of the Fall did. But yeah, Oppenheimer's, it was a very good film. Only Christopher Nolan can make doctors look cool.
Cool.
Doctors and scientists. Like, only Christopher Nolan can do
that. Can
do that,
yeah.
It was a great movie, and Murphy was awesome. I loved, did you ever see the, what was it called? It was called At a Time. It was a Justin Timberlake movie. Rob, do you know what I'm talking, Director Rob. I feel like that's something that he would
Director
know.
Director Rob would definitely know.
Justin, you ever see the movie Out of Time? Have you ever seen the movie Out of Time with Justin Timberlake? Okay.
Mm.
So.
We thought you would have.
Let's see if that's right. Out of Time, Justin Timberlake. Yeah, it is Out of Time. So he, oh, In Time.
In Time.
In Time.
Oh, yes, I did see that.
So
yes,
the
yes.
purpose is you don't get paid in money, you get paid in time.
Right.
And like, if you don't get time in time,
and if your
time
runs out, you're gone.
And if you have a bajillion hours, you'll live
forever.
At
right.
like 30 years old.
Right.
He played the cop that was investigating, Murphy did, investigating, Justin Timberlake for stealing time at some point.
Mm.
And then Peaky Blinders, have you seen Peaky Blinders?
I have not.
It's like 1920s British gangsters.
Mm-hmm.
He plays Tommy Shelby, the leader of the Shelby family. He is so good. And obviously he's in Scarecrow and Christopher Nolan stuff.
Yep.
He's pretty much in every Christopher Nolan movie.
This is John Batiste performing Never Went Away from American Symphony. So we're down to some of the big categories now. I think we'll probably still see original
yep.
and documentary short before the big categories like directing, cinematography,
correct.
Lead actor and one of the night. So they started earlier this year, so they're rolling through these. We're just making some adjustments here. We've got another live interview coming up here in just a short while. But going to the comments on our Facebook page, somebody was saying, now I guess I got to see Poor Things.
You have
your recommendation.
It's just the weirdest thing in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Look, I love sci-fi. I like strange things. I'm a Tim Burton fan. It is the craziest movie, weirdest movie I've ever seen in my life. But there is a lot of adult content.
Like a lot of adult content.
Yes, yes.
Especially when a lot of actresses and actors are even kind of pushing back to sex scenes. Because you even see it like trending on Twitter or Instagram, you know, name the most pointless sex scene ever in a film. And I know Oppenheimer had a couple of them that people were just crushing them for. But Emma Stone was like, I'm going to show you the prime, the primitive mind of a human, what really we want. That's all she wanted in that movie. I'm sure she wants an Oscar out of it. All right, we have another guest. Welcome. Tell us a little about yourself.
Hi, thank you for having me. My name is Genevieve Growl. I'm a local filmmaker. I recently moved to Milwaukee, actually from Kenosha.
Okay.
There's a trend
you're the
here.
Co-director, right?
Yes, Genevieve. Yeah.
I made a short film called Oh Rats. It's a psychological thriller.
Oh Rats?
Yes.
I'm writing these down because I want to see these
a
films.
A psychological thriller.
Is really?
It a short?
Yeah, I consider it. It's 24 minutes, okay. So a lot of people consider it to be a bit of a longer short. I know a lot of people, especially in festival season, people kind of prefer that, you know, between that 8 to like 13 minute runtime. But I just kind of wanted to really push my boundaries and to really almost kind of fully, like, you know, expose myself to that filmmaking lifestyle, especially trying to make a feature. It's a lot of work, so I kind of just am trying to like do it like level by level, and hopefully like my next film will eventually reach that 60-minute mark.
What was it about? Like a quick synopsis.
So it's actually funny that you explained it because I saw that you were kind of trash talking Poor Things a little bit, and I
not trash talking. I liked Poor Things. I really did. It was just weird.
It was weird.
That's all I could say about it.
It was weird. And if you find that strange, do not watch his previous film, Red Lobster.
Oh, yeah.
That was one that I had a hard time.
Bizarre.
Yeah.
Okay.
But my film actually kind of does have a little bit of experimental undertones, I would say. Okay. So a lot of people, especially because as a beginner filmmaker, this is my second film I've ever made, trying to like experiment with more absurdism films like the one I recently made is a bit of a challenge. So my film kind of takes place within this, I would say, tumultuous relationship between two characters named Kenny and Jane. And you kind of see them have this situation where one night Kenny went out to a party and he texts a bunch of stuff to his girlfriend Jane. And before she can read them, he calls her and says, hey, don't read these texts. So just throughout this film, you kind of see the protagonist, Jane, you know, contemplating, like, oh, should I read these texts? Should I not? And at the end, like, you know, the audience really wants to know what these texts said. But, you know, I'm not going to say anything yet because you guys have to watch it.
Right.
No, I like it. No, I like that.
So you said experimental undertones.
Yeah.
So then something like Poor Things is right up your alley.
Right up, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. At first, I was a little skeptical. Like, I know that... Yorgos Lanthimos is known to be a bit, I don't know how to describe it, like a little bit obscure.
Yeah.
So I've seen some of his films. It's really a hit or miss.
Yeah.
This has probably been, Poor Things has probably been my favorite out of his creations that he's made. I really do think Emma Stone just brought a lot of life to it.
She was awesome.
She was great, yeah.
I mean, look, if she wasn't going against some of these other amazing actresses that are in this category, I know she's won the British Award, she's won another one, but the actress from Flower of the Killer's Moon, why am I blanking on it?
Lily Gladstone, yeah.
Who won, what, the Golden Globe
between,
and the SAG?
Between both of them, yeah.
Yeah. Well, Genevieve, thank you so much. I'm going to have to, where can I watch yours?
Where can we find O-Rats?
I'm going to actually publish it on YouTube today.
All right.
All right.
O-Rats on YouTube. Well, Genevieve, thanks so much. We'll definitely be on the lookout for you because you said you're doing another film soon, right?
Yes. I'm planning on helping out on actually two films.
Okay.
With my friend Mary, who was recently interviewed. Mm-hmm. And then I'm currently making a short myself.
Okay.
I'm still in the writing process, so I'm not sure when it will be, you know, shot. But I'm
not going to rush an artist.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Genevieve. We appreciate you taking some time out with us today.
Yeah. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. You are watching us here on 12 News, the 12 News Facebook page, our Oscars live watch party, our annual watch party. Derek Rose, Dara Melendez here taking over for the team. We are watching the Oscars here, and we've got a Guillermo bit going on.
Guillermo sighting.
Guillermo and, I'm guessing, tequila. To win tickets to a premiere of Shirley. It is a new film. John Ridley, that's going to be premiering soon. So you have a chance to win tickets to the premiere celebration and a VIP reception. ASN.com/Shirley. It won't cost you anything. It's completely to win what is probably going to be a great film by John Ridley, and the award they are presenting
for Best Documentary Short and Best documentary feature.
It's America Ferrera. And remind me of her name.
Kate McKinnon?
Yes. From SNL.
Very, very funny lady.
Okay, excellent. Well, that'll be perfect.
That was good.
Dr. Spielberg.
This is awesome.
And in the documentary short category, which we're going to get to in just a second, there is one film with a Milwaukee
tie. That's right.
Tie.
That's right.
UWM grad Josh Rosenberg, nominated for The Last Repair Shop in the documentary series. So he'll be going up against Island of Between, The Barber of Little Rock, and ABC's of Book Banning.
Born in Green Bay and went to UWM.
So here we go. Here are the nominees.
ABC's of Book Banning. This one is stuck. Island in Between. The Last Repair Shop. That's the one we're rooting for. Only because of the local ties here.
Yep. Josh Rosenberg, UWM grad.
And win or lose, we got to get in touch with Josh Rosenberg and talk to him about this film.
He won!
Nice!
Oh, Milwaukee,
this is
get
awesome.
Action. Taking home some gold. Josh Rosenberg. Nominated for last.
This might be our
shop.
Moment for the night right here.
Here
I like
we go.
This. Yes. And I got it. Full transparency. We weren't aware about Josh Rosenberg, but our great friend and colleague Joyce Garbasiak texted our news director to let us know that Josh Rosenberg was nominated, a UWM graduate, Green Bay native, for The Last Repair Shop, documentary short.
It just goes to show Sconnies do everything the best.
That's right. And that's some inspiration for our local for sure. filmmakers as well. We've been talking to a number of folks who've been here
up there.
Making films here in the area.
Let's hear the speech.
Yeah.
So that. And so that's very cool. All right.
Oh, documentary feature here.
To Kill a Tiger. Now, unfortunately, I didn't get to these categories.
Correct.
There you go. All right. So let's find out who is going to win. Then we have a very special guest, Riley, who's sitting next to us. Mm-hmm. We don't want to ignore Riley, but he knows a lot about this.
20 Days in Mariupol.
So 20 Days in Mariupol. I had that one easy. Check. Riley, we've been told you know something a little bit about documentaries, correct?
Yes. Yes, I do.
So how so? Like, what is your documentary background?
Yes. So after high school, I took a gap year, and I committed that gap year basically to producing and directing a kind of a feature length. We hit the 46-minute mark, so it's technically a feature.
Okay.
Documentary about family caregivers in Wisconsin taking care of their loved ones with dementia and Alzheimer's.
Mm-hmm. So so if you go over 46 minutes, you just said, it's not a documentary?
No, technically, well, yes, it's still a documentary, but we technically got that like feature length qualification for the documentary.
I never knew that was a thing.
Yeah. Huh. Well, at least that's what I looked up, so let's hope that's right.
What was your favorite part of the process? Because obviously we just saw documentary, short film, and feature. By the way, did you see any of these?
I haven't, but I want to see the UWM grad one.
Yeah. Josh Rosenberg for the last repair shop for a documentary short film. But what's that process like? Because obviously I'm guessing it's different than a feature film.
Yes, it's very different than doing a feature film, because with a feature film you have all this production planning of what you're filming, all the actors are on the same page.
Right.
Not that there isn't room for improvisation, but a lot of it's already planned and already set. With documentary filmmaking, you go through the same steps of pre-planning of what you're trying to capture and the mm-hmm. things you're trying to get, but it's completely random what the people that you interview with and what they have to say about the subject. So going into it, you have all these questions and stuff consistent, but each person has their own different take on it.
Right.
So editing around that is always kind of a puzzle.
And does the story, I guess, if you will, change?
Absolutely.
As you're going through the process, you may have one premise, but as you speak to people and as they tell you and give you their perspective on whatever the subject matter is, it kind of changes what the end product will be.
Absolutely. I know with our documentary, our whole second section was kind of just came to be after we interviewed a couple of the people and mm-hmm. we were like, there's more to the story than mm-hmm. we thought. And mm-hmm. so we actually ended up doing a whole section of the documentary based off of what they had said. So it very much changes during the filming process and sometimes can be completely different than what you had started and set out to do.
Is that fun or frustrating?
Both.
Because I'm guessing you have a plan. It's like, oh, I know this story. I know what I want to do. I just need to get the right bites. And then you do the interview. It's like, oh, man, I got to throw out everything.
I totally didn't. Right.
Yes, absolutely. It's both fun and frustrating. It's frustrating in the standpoint of sometimes you're like, I don't know if this is going to work out. I don't know if this is going to make it in. I'm not sure if this is going to fit in the overall story. But in that frustration is part of the fun of finding out how to fit that into the narrative and how sometimes your film completely changes and becomes better because of it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you realize during the process that the film you had before wasn't as good as the film you have now, because of these things that are added into it. And that part's really fun to be able to discover that and work with that.
Man, I would be so annoyed that I would have put so much prep work. Like, I know this story like the back of my hand. Right. I know what's going to happen.
Right.
Then you do that one interview. And it's like,
well, what's funny is the work that we do. We cover stories similar, all the time. Yeah. But there's some different stories that I've covered in my time here in Milwaukee. And I'm like, that could make an interesting documentary.
Oh, for sure.
So what was it that kind of drew you into documentary filmmaking to do this?
It was it was my first film project, like big film project. I had done editing with YouTubers before, and I'd run my own little freelancing business with clients and stuff. But this was my first production-based project, and mm-hmm. something that I really wanted to do. And that came actually through the process of a client before that was like, hey, I filmed something for them, and they were like, let's expand upon this, and let's make a film. And I was all over that after high school because I was like, I want to make films. I'm all over that. So that process kind of started from that, and as I got more involved with interviewing and closer to the family caregivers, it became more of a passion project, more of something that I really wanted to share with people. Because at the point in my life, it was something that I was completely new to. I hadn't dealt with anyone with dementia or Alzheimer's. And so learning all these stories with them and spending time with them really, really became something that I was just, I don't want to say obsessed with, but something that I just loved doing and mm-hmm. something that I wanted to share with people. So it started as kind of an idea from another person and then kind of warped into a passion project of mine to be able to do.
Well, Riley, thank you so much for taking the time today. That was great. What is your documentary?
It's called Unconditional, A Journey of Selfless Love.
Okay.
You can get it on Prime or Tubi. It's nice. On those two, so if you want to...
Tubi?
Yes.
Man, I'm old. I don't know what the heck Tubi is.
Oh, I've heard Tubi.
I've never heard Tubi.
Tubi Films?
Huh. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
You can get it on either of those, so...
My son's going to be very disappointed.
Unconditional...
A Journey of Selfless Love.
A Journey of Selfless Love. All right.
Well, Riley, thank you so much for
awesome.
Sharing
thank
your
you
story.
So much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, so while Riley was up here with us, we did documentary short film, which you saw, obviously, mm-hmm. John's repair shop, mm-hmm. Documentary film, 20 Days in Mariupol. I'm going to say that's the name of that. If you're wondering for wins, who's the clubhouse leader right now, Poor Things has 4 wins for costume design, original score, effects. That should come as no surprise to anybody that has won it. And I know when we were with Genevieve, she thought we were trash talking Poor Things. No one's trash talking Poor Things. It was great. It was just weird.
Just very weird.
And that's kind of the MO of the director of Poor Things. He kind of does films that... are make you a little uncomfortable and are mm-hmm. or outside the box thinking. And then Oppenheimer, who's the front runner for a lot of these films, he has 2 wins so far. They have Robert Downey Jr. for Best Supporting Actor, and then they have film editing. So the next category that's gonna be coming up, Achievement in Cinematography.
Oppenheimer's on this category, along with Killers of the Flower Moon as well, and Poor Things, and Maestro.
I mean, I'm guessing Oppenheimer wins this one. Oh, Poor Things. It's got to be Poor Things or Oppenheimer. So we have another guest, Dominic, who's also into documentaries. Dominic, thanks so much for joining us. Who wins?
Might be Poor Things.
Oppenheimer. See, it was going to be either one. It was one or the other. Because those two, the way they were edited
the
together.
The way
so
they were, yes.
Best cinematography.
Yes.
It's Christopher Nolan. Of course he's going to win Best Cinematography. So again, we talked about it. Oppenheimer now has 3, so one more away from tying Poor Things. Let me just check that off my list before we move on so I don't forget things. And there it is, Poor Things. So Dominic, we just had our documentary film session. We talked about short film winner, which is a UWM grad, and feature films. You do documentaries. Did you watch any of these by any chance?
I haven't. These past few months, I've been really busy just focusing on myself. So literally, I haven't had the time to sit down and watch much. I'm not going to lie to you.
So tell us about your documentary then.
It's an autobiographical documentary about my life and my family, essentially, through the lens of my family members. Mm-hmm. So it was really cool to get to interview my family because not many of them are really camera friendly. So being able to break that comfortability barrier is really cool. And getting to talk about myself, obviously, was very interesting.
How nervous were you going into that project?
Because I don't want to know what anyone
when you're
going
to talk to your own family members, you never know what they're going to say. Kind of take us through that decision making of making this project so personal.
Yeah, well, so it was actually a piece for my foundation review at UWM. So essentially what that is that film, it was my second time, and you only get 2 times to do a foundation review. So essentially, if I didn't pass this foundation review, I couldn't advance in the film major at UWM. So there was a lot riding on that. So on top of that, with the, you know, the personal attachment to that, it was very tricky because I didn't really know what they were going to say.
Right.
And so it was honestly just whatever I got in those interviews, it was going to be put in the film. Mm-hmm. But it was really cool to get to hear how my family felt kind of about my passion and my film career, essentially, because I've been doing this my entire life. Mm-hmm. So it was really heartwarming to hear all the great things they had to say about me.
Did anybody hold back? Give you the...
They gave the full...
What was the worst thing you heard? What was the thing that was like, oh, come on, man, that's not me?
Just kind of the... I don't know. I actually haven't thought about that, to be honest.
You didn't brush your teeth when you were little. You don't make your bed.
Yeah, no, some of the stories. I don't know how to swim. They talked about that. But I didn't put that in there because I didn't want anybody to know.
You don't know how to swim, or you do?
I don't. So I didn't want to put that in there because...
What would you say was the most emotional thing that you heard from one of your relatives?
So rest in peace to my father. He passed away in 2014. So hear my mother talk about that, it was very touching, and it was a touchy subject, of course. So just having to listen and hear my mom, you know, re-go through those memories, it was very
tough.
Tough to hear that for sure.
All right, so live action short is just being announced. The wonderful story of it's a Wes Anderson film. So that's his first win. Really? Wes Anderson gets his first Oscar win.
Out of 8 nominations.
I never would have thought that, because obviously he's Wes Anderson. Like, he has so many amazing movies. So Wes Anderson takes home his first Oscar win.
And which one was that? Which film was that?
That was for live action short film, The Wonderful Story of Henry Sugar.
Henry Sugar.
Good for Wes Anderson. So is this kind of like your goal one day to have something nominated for an Oscar?
This is my end goal. I'm not stopping until I get that goal.
I like
sure.
that.
That's awesome.
I like that.
Well, I mean, you've seen, I'm guessing, tons of documentaries, tons of movies. Is there like a common theme with these ones that win that you're trying to like emulate? Because obviously there's a recipe, right? Mm-hmm. There's a recipe for a lot of these directors and filmmakers that continue to win award after award.
Yeah, for me, honestly, I'm a real fan of cinematography. And for example, my mother, she loves the appeal of the eye in film. And so for me, I really try to emulate that strong cinematography in my films and documentaries, because having the substance of the film isn't an issue. It's the visual effects. And so I really try to emulate that really strong eye opening effects in the film.
It's the memorable moments. Poor Things won this year. Did you get to watch Poor Things by any chance? Are you old enough to watch Poor Things?
Maybe not.
It's a lot of fisheye. It's a lot of low angle.
I don't think we're old enough to watch it.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm old enough to watch that. So, I mean, to your point, cinematography, they're memorable movies. That's why we always talk about Citizen Kane. Mm-hmm. It's a movie that you watch in most documentary classes, most filmmaking classes.
I would say that you study from.
It was just so different at the time, because everything was set in studios, and this was the first one that had like a roof on a studio. Mm-hmm. So you could shoot up. It's like, oh, interesting. We never thought we could do that, to make someone look a little bit more commanding. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, to your point, like that cinematography, I'm guessing that's something you really try to work on with your stuff,
100%.
Right? 100%. How do you do that?
For me, honestly, and this is kind of just me self-teaching myself of film, it's just honestly filming something and what I think looks cool. And then I have a vision, so when I'm filming, it's like, okay, if I film it a certain way, I'm imagining what it looks like in the editing room. And so with having that kind of going into a shoot, it really helps me post-production.
Do you have a certain style?
Not really, no.
But you're thinking about the editing while you're shooting, which is important.
Mm-hmm, because for me, it's like killing two birds with one stone, essentially.
Yes.
So I find a lot of success in that.
Because you don't want to shoot yourself into a corner, and you can't edit out of it. So,
yeah.
I like that.
Well, Dominic, thank you so much for sharing. What is the name of your documentary?
It's called Home.
Home?
Home.
I like that. And is it out yet, or are you still working on it?
Yeah, so we premiered it at the showcase here at No Studios, and it's on YouTube and Vimeo right now.
Okay, nice. Well, Vimeo I've heard of.
Yes.
Tubi, not so much.
I got to introduce you to Tubi.
Yeah, I'm going to hook you to Tubi. Dominic, thanks so much, man.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
It
was my pleasure.
Absolutely. And we have another filmmaker that's going to be coming to talk to us here shortly while we get set. But while we do that, we want to remind you that you have a chance to win a... VIP reception for Shirley, the new film from John Ridley. You should know his name here. Behind No Studios and this this collective here for creatives. Ridley screening room here at No Studios where they screen films.
Oh my gosh, I just put that together.
Yeah, that just clicked.
Oh my God. Now I feel stupid. Thank you, Derek.
And there's a shot of the screening room where we have a lot of folks here for the annual watch party here at No Studios for the Oscars. So a lot going on here and a lot of local filmmakers coming through. And one of them is with us now. His name is Casey. And Casey, we understand you made a sci-fi film.
Yeah, very philosophical sci-fi movie where it's called Quran. It stars a very prolific local actor named Mario Andre Alberts, and it's a gentleman who is on a broken-down spaceship drifting through space and contemplating his life choices, everything that's happened.
That's the type of sci-fi I can get into.
Right.
So we've been talking about Poor Things.
Yes.
All night.
Yes.
Poor Things is considered sci-fi / comedy. Did you get to see it?
Oh, I did. I've seen it three times, actually.
You've seen it three times?
I've seen it three times. Well, I saw it twice in the theater, and then I just turned on Hulu the other night, and it's like, there it was. I was like, well, I got to watch it again.
So did you see it three times because you liked it, or that you were...
You wanted to go back and learn
new
things?
There was just so much. Like I feel like I need to watch it again because there was so much I feel like I missed.
To process new stuff?
I saw it the first time and I loved it the first time, but then I found myself over the next like 3 or 4 days, images and scenes from it just kept going through my head. And I was like, that's a sign I really need to go back and see it again. So I had a free night. I was like, hey, I'm going to go check it out.
Nice. So when you watch that film for the second or third time, what are you looking for?
You know,
as a director, as a filmmaker.
You know, the first time you just want to be taken away, just like anybody else. People think you make movies and it ruins the experience for you. On the contrary, but definitely the second time that you watch it, you have a lot more awareness of the craftsmanship, everything that went into it, the performances. The first time I couldn't take my eyes off of Emma Stone. The second time I couldn't take my eyes off of Mark Ruffalo. Like they were just both so brilliant.
Mark Ruffalo was really good.
You know.
But I think that's kind of the point. Like you don't want to take your eyes off Emma Stone with like her role and the things she's doing. It just caught me off guard. And I think that's what I like about films sometimes, when they catch you off guard.
Yeah.
Because I knew what the movie was, but I wasn't expecting how primitive it was, right?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. And it's like time out of time, very steampunky and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, for sure.
Do you ever like watch these movies and see if you can, or like take not pointers, but like duplicate certain things? Like that fisheye, the fisheye shot that they do a lot.
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen that in a lot of movies.
That's a lot in Poor Things?
It's cool. It's like looking through a peephole.
I'm a nerd. They used a 4mm lens. And
okay.
I haven't seen anything like that since like skate videos in the 90s that like Spike Jonze was doing, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was very fascinating. I did find myself, particularly the third time I watched it, trying to decipher why they chose a specific lens for a specific shot. Like, why was the fisheye on this shot and not the next shot, you know?
That because kind of in Maestro, did you see Maestro by any chance?
I have not seen Maestro.
So Maestro is the closest, and I keep bringing up Citizen Kane because that's kind of like the basis for it, but it's like they meet in the 40s, so they're shooting on a 1940s camera. Mm-hmm. And as it goes, like the camera and the picture gets clearer and clearer because you're kind of going through their life.
The evolution.
So like it's cool to see, and I understood that. Because I see what they're doing there. I didn't understand. It was kind of just in Poor Things, hey, this camera angle is cool in this one, so we're just going to use it.
You know, filmmaking secret, sometimes that's why you do it. People go, oh, this must mean something. Nah, it just looked cool, you know?
So what's your favorite? Oh, because now they're doing achievement in sound. How important is this, by the way?
It's insanely important. It's insanely important. It's like movies are just as much sound as they are a visual. Because, and if you don't believe me, make a film and don't have the sound mix done yet, and try to watch it. It will affect you in ways that you never knew.
A bit difficult there.
Yeah.
Because I know chefs talk about that a lot. It's not, you're not just eating something, you're visually looking at it as well. So I'm guessing it's the same thing. You're not just visually seeing something, you're hearing it as well.
Yeah, it's an extraordinarily important. Film is one of those disciplines that involves every art form on the planet, and sound is just one of them.
So, okay, the nominees for sound are The Creator, which I didn't get to see, I'd like to see. Maestro, which is awesome for sound, especially, I mean, he's a composer. Lenny Bernstein. Bernstein, I should say. Mission Impossible, Dead Reckoning was great. Oppenheimer, Zone of Interest. Have you seen these movies?
Yeah, I've seen some of them.
Which one do you think?
You know, it's really hard because they did interesting things with sound in the Zone of Interest. Like, the Zone of Interest sound is a character in the movie.
It's its own character.
You know?
I didn't even think about that.
But honestly, like, as a person who's done a lot of sound mixing in my life as well, like, when I went and saw the 70mm print of Oppenheimer, like, during the nuclear test, there were so many separate sounds, I was really just impressed by it.
Yeah, I mean, I was kind of leaning toward Oppenheimer or Maestro. Mm-hmm. Zone of Interest, though, I didn't even think about that.
You think about the sound as a character itself.
Yeah. God, what a crazy movie that was. I mean, it just...
And could that be the reason it wins, if it does in fact win? They're showing clips from the nominees right now. They're starting out with Creator.
Now that we did the whole sound conversation, I'm like glued to
you're like listening to see.
I really want to see.
Absolutely.
Look, Mission Impossible, Dead Reckoning. I was saying this before. I'm not a big Leonardo DiCaprio fan as a person, I guess. And I'm not a big Tom Cruise fan as a person. But I love all their movies. It's the weirdest thing in the world. So I guess I am a Leo fan and a Tom Cruise fan. I don't know. But Maestro was really good. I was surprised how good Bradley Cooper was. His range as an actor is just phenomenal.
Yeah, he commits. He commits in a big way.
It's cool to see. It really is.
I'm predicting Oppenheimer.
Oppenheimer?
Mm-hmm. Zone of Interest.
You there called we go.
It. Because
there
it's, we go. It's a character.
It's a character in the movie.
That is it right there.
Cool.
You called it.
That's I kind great. Of know my stuff.
kind of a big
How
deal.
How long have you been doing this? How long have you been in filmmaking?
About 20 years.
Okay.
Yeah, a long time.
So I would have never... thought Zone of Interest win until you said it was a character
itself.
Which you 100% are right. Mm-hmm. The problem is I was reading so much that I think it took away from me wanting to like listen to everything.
Yeah.
Because a lot, I was just reading the subtitle.
It happens sometimes. Yeah. You'll just have to go watch it again though.
Yeah, now I have to listen to it.
Zone of Interest.
Well, Casey, thank you so much. This was great.
Yes, thank you.
The name of your movie is again?
Quran. Quran. It's the name Quran.
Quran.
Yep.
Gotcha. All right.
Well, awesome, Casey. You were the perfect one to have up here for that. That was
and perfect
great.
Timing, too, especially considering the sound discussion.
That was awesome.
And I haven't missed I'm Just Ken yet, so that's good, too.
That's right. That performance, that's nice.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, awesome, Casey. Thanks so
Casey,
much.
Thanks
so much.
A lot. We appreciate it.
So if you're watching at home, obviously Zone of Interest took over. Casey pretty much called it for best sound in a motion picture. Beat out Oppenheimer, beat out Maestro, Mission Impossible, Dead Reckoning Part 1, and The Creator. Zone of Interest, as you heard Casey point out, was the sound was kind of another character. And if you don't know the backstory of the movie, it is a Nazi Auschwitz commander trying to have a white picket fence style life.
Normal, quote unquote, life.
Outside walls of Auschwitz, which... it was really part of life. I was fortunate enough to go to Berlin this summer. Mm-hmm. I went to Sachsenhausen, which was the concentration camp outside. And all of them lived right around the concentration camp. And you just don't expect to see that these guards kind of try to live normal lives.
Is this? This is Ryan Gosling. Performing right now. While this is happening, Larson, can you do me a favor? Wins by film. I think Oppenheimer has 3 and Poor Things has 4 or 5 maybe?
4, I believe.
You can just get a tally.
And everybody else just has 1.
Right.
Oh, no, Zone of Interest might have 2. Zone of Interest has 2.
Because there was all this talk about how Oppenheimer was going to sweep so many categories.
It was striking out early on, but it's now come back on. So
Holdovers has one.
Three for Oppenheimer.
Poor Things is
three
four.
Three for Poor Things? I thought there was four.
I got Poor Things as costume design, cinematography, original score. No, what's original score then?
Original score hasn't gone yet?
Oh, sorry.
Then we mistakenly, we mistakenly put that one on. So then it's 3-3 right now, Oppenheimer and Poor Things. And then Zone of Interest has two. And that was going to be the next one I was going to watch, too. I might watch that one tonight.
Yeah, so Poor Things is then production design, cinematography. No, hair and makeup, too. Right?
For what, Poor Things?
Poor Things.
Poor
hair
things
and makeup. So that's... So what is... So, okay,
poor
hair and things.
Costume design.
Production design. Yes? Production design, costume design, cinematography. No cinematography? Oppenheimer was cinematography?
Yeah, Oppenheimer was cinematography.
And then, so then hair and makeup was Poor Things, perfect. So then Oppenheimer was cinematography, Robert Downey Jr., and film editing. Am I missing any other? Film that should editing. Be it, okay.
Yep,
now
that should be
now
it.
We're all good. Now we got our bingo card, what? Editing.
Editing, yeah. Film editing, right. Oppenheimer. Yeah, okay.
Now we're all good. Now we can get to our next guest, Warren.
Warren.
And hey Warren, sorry, we were trying to get our bingo card ready.
I didn't get one of those. I would like to be a part
I
of that.
I think we have one.
We can make that happen.
Awesome.
I can make it happen right now. Here you go.
Yeah.
Ask and you shall receive.
So we obviously had the documentary, short films, and features a couple categories ago. A UWM grad, Josh Rosenberg, was part of the short film documentary, The Last Repair Shop. Any chance you saw any of these?
I did not see any of the short. Are you talking about documentary feature?
Documentary short film.
Yeah. No, I did not.
Okay. What about documentary feature?
Yeah, the 20 Days in Maripol.
You did see
the
one that won. You did see that one.
It was incredible.
Was it?
Yeah.
Can you give us a little synopsis? I didn't get to see it.
Well, you know, you're looking at the invasion in Ukraine from almost like day one to day 20, and you're from the perspective of being inside the hospital, and the hospital was being bombed, and it's like, what are these people going to be doing?
Huh. Wow.
So it was like a thriller documentary.
Really?
Yeah.
So, and I'm guessing they were in the hospital. Like, these filmmakers were in the hospital putting their lives on the line to capture this history.
Yeah, and there you can see the filmmakers themselves moving from location to location just in front of the tanks that are about to bomb
had
just been.
That's got to be...
It's incredible.
Horrifying.
Yeah.
As a documentary filmmaker yourself, I mean, when you see something like that, do you feel for them a little bit?
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, because you're discovering the story that you don't know. It's just unfolding.
In real time.
Yeah, and I think as a documentarian, you don't want to put yourself into the film as much as allow that story to come through you.
Right.
And try to keep that as unfiltered. But it's hard not to be emotionally moved in the midst of capturing and making a documentary. Yeah.
So what's the documentary that, first off, how many have you made?
So this is my happy accident first documentary.
Happy accident? Okay, how's it a happy accident?
The happy accident is in September 20th, 2017. I ran into Joe West performing at the Nashville airport.
Huh.
And got there way early. I was listening to him play. And as I was looking at my phone, and he said my name, Warren, this next song is for you. And I was surprised. I had just greeted him, put $20, into his case, and we exchanged pleasantries. But then he sang a song that made me cry.
Wow.
It was incredible. And so...
What was the song?
It's called Come Quickly, Lord. And it's a song of faith.
Mm-hmm.
And he ended up coming and sitting down by me, and he goes, hey, man, tell me your story. And I wanted to know his story.
Mm.
So I told him a real quick story about having written a racial reconciliation play back in 2014. Mm-hmm. And he goes, well, that's awesome. I said, what's your story? And he told me his mom and dad was America's first black country western duo.
Oh,
I said, really? Yes,
really?
Sergeant Shirley West. They recorded with Charlie Pride's bandsmen back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
And, Charlie Pride was the only black country western superstar at the time. Mm-hmm. And so, but they got signed, but they never made it big. They didn't tour. They had a family and some other health issues. So this this, I said, how would you like to do a documentary about your family? And so within 25 minutes, we became best friends. It was incredible. Yeah. So now 7 years later, we've got this film called A Song Can Change a Life. And I went back to Nashville, and about 3 months later, I said, hey, let's hang out all day. Tell me the story. And that's when he told me about him and his dad were estranged for years. They were not on speaking terms, and he had some hurt. So he was living in Chicago, and somebody said, Joe, you really need to forgive your dad. And he goes, I know, but I don't even know how to begin. But like his daddy, he's a singer-songwriter, and he wrote a song wrote a song called Daddy, went home on vacation, and he sang it to his family, and everybody lost it. Wow. He said it was first time him and his dad, with tears, embraced each other and said, I love you.
Wow.
So a song can change a life.
Well, I mean, it changed your life. You were sitting in an airport, you said?
Yeah.
How crazy is that? Where were you going to?
Happy accident is an understatement.
I was coming back from Nashville at a storytelling conference. And coming back home to Milwaukee.
So maybe you were a little inspired, like from that conference.
The day before, there was a speaker, and I'm forgetting his name, but he had won a documentary award for Sports Illustrated, Joe Namath's third Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, people ask him, where do we find these great stories to tell? And his answer was, you don't.
Yeah, they find you.
They find
that's
you.
That's it. That's they it. And within 24 hours later,
exactly,
we are on this incredible journey.
Wow. That is an amazing story.
It's so fun. It is so fun.
You have to tell this story on the back end of the film, just like a behind the scenes.
Yeah, they could make a documentary on you making a documentary.
Yeah, actually, it made its way in there, because I had joked with him. I said, hey, do you have any saxophones in the cases? And I said, no. And I said, oh, I thought maybe I could sit in with you. And he got scared. He didn't know if I had a sax. He goes, oh, the management has rules about doing that. And I said, I'm just kidding. Maybe I'll have you come up to Milwaukee.
Yeah.
So in 2019, November, he came up to Milwaukee with his family. We did a concert at the PAC, and we showed the first cut of this film.
Of the film.
And he went through a whole box of Kleenex, as you can imagine.
So in 19 was the first cut. When did it release? Because obviously 19, we know what happens in 2020.
Yeah, I know. Right. It really messed us up with the film festival. So in 21 is when we started doing film festivals.
Okay.
And so now in the final cut, it's actually, there's a piece with me playing my saxophone at the PAC with Joe.
That's really, that is really awesome. Cool. I love that. And it's called A Song Can Change a Life.
Yes.
That is really,
and if you go to
really
asongcanchangealife.com, that's where you'll find our film.
Nice.
Song, that's great.
I love that story.
That actually must have been pretty, I'm guessing, nerve-wracking for you, like the COVID year, because you're so close to the finish line, right? You showed the first cut, you're getting ready for festival season, and then boom, everything shuts down.
Yeah, it was really disappointing, but it actually turned out really good.
Yeah.
Because it ended up opening up some other doors. We had a little more time and whatnot. And then we were able to put some shows together, so it was super fun.
Well, Warren, thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for sharing that story.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
That is really,
really
amazing.
Appreciate it. Warren, and again, what is your documentary called one more time?
It's called A Song Can Change a Life with Crossword
Perfect.
Films.
All right.
Excellent. Well, Warren, thanks so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, everybody, for watching out there. We got some more. What is this next category coming up?
This is Cynthia Erivo and Ariana Grande.
Original score and original song. Now we're going to original score and original song. Okay.
And after these two categories, we're down to the big ones of the night.
Oh, see, I'm a huge Indiana Jones fan.
Me too.
So, like, I want that to win so bad.
Yeah, Killers of the Flower Moon. Really good film.
I mean, obviously, Oppenheimer was great.
I like the voice of the person who's narrating the nominees.
Oppenheimer. He should win something. Original score, here we go. Come on, Indiana Jones. Come on, Indy.
Oppenheimer.
Here we go. Oppenheimer's starting to take off, folks.
Starting to pull away.
So that's now four for Oppenheimer.
Oppenheimer, this was score?
Score, yes. Oh, one for Black Panther.
Oh, okay.
That's cool.
And while they're doing the acceptance speech there, we have another guest for us. This is Paige, who is a local filmmaker here in the Milwaukee area. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
So my name's Paige Strubler. I am a senior at UW-Milwaukee studying film. I like to make films that express myself. I think it's really fun being in Milwaukee as filmmaking. There's such a great community here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love it.
So it says your title is experimental?
That is the type of film I make, yes.
Okay, what is an experimental film?
Yeah.
So it's kind of a new and upcoming like film genre. It's not super popular, but it's, I guess, more of an artistic way to express yourself in film. So you could do like crazy exposed 16 millimeter filmmaking or mm-hmm. just really anything to tell your story that's not a constructive narrative in a way.
And that traditional? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Are there any films that are nominated? So like American Fiction, Anatomy of the Fall, Barbie Holdovers, any of these films that you've seen that are kind of like that? I'm guessing off the top it's going to be like four things.
Yeah, that's kind of what comes to mind. I mean, it is still like narrative, but I guess the way it's expressed and like cinematography and everything is more experimental than I think what we've seen before.
So why that route for you?
Honestly, it's a very big, I guess, category in the filmmaking industry here. So I got to learn a little bit more about it in school and I really enjoy it.
Very cool. So best original song goes to Barbie. So that's Billie Eilish. So that's her Oscar. She's only
tonight?
20, no, ever.
Ever, okay.
She's only 22 years old. So
she's
the
got two
youngest
Oscars.
To ever win two Oscars. This song also won the Grammy as well.
That's what, yes. That's
and
what
that was for the James Bond movie a couple years ago she won the other Oscar for. So Billie Eilish is just
killing it. Killing the game. Crushing the game.
Now back to experimental films. Obviously, you're saying a lot of it has to do with the lighting, the exposure. What about sound? Because we're in original score, we're in original song. We just had another director up here saying how important sound is.
Yeah, definitely. Sound is a big part of experimental filmmaking. There's actually films that are based completely in sound that are very experimental.
Really?
Kind of, you could have, I guess, like a picture and the story is told through the sound. So it's a really interesting way of telling stories as
how
well.
Do you tell a story through sound?
It's just kind of about how you experience the image on the screen. Mm. So it's really about how it provokes emotions in you, mm-hmm. stuff like that. Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That is really cool. Do you have a film you're working on?
I'm actually working on my senior film. It's a little less experimental than what I've made prior, but it still has some of those elements in it, definitely.
Made prior, so you've done this, this isn't your first rodeo.
No, yeah. Being in film school has helped me kind of expand my portfolio a lot, for sure.
So, you said this one's a little less experimental.
It is.
How far out have you gone?
Not as far as I would like to.
Okay, how far do you want to go?
As far as it takes me. I mean, there's no limits.
So what's like crazy? What's crazy experimental?
I guess crazy experimental is some like really cool shapes on the screen, some really crazy sounds. It's just kind of like, what am I watching? But I love what I'm watching.
What am I watching? But I love what I'm watching. Yes. I like that. God, that's cool, man. I never would have thought that. So, you toned this last one down, you said. How so? Like, how is it toned down?
It's just kind of how I was telling the story. It's a little more personal. It's more of a drama. So I think when I was writing the script, it came out a little bit more narrative than my original films.
See, I just, like, I think I know movies.
But and
I
then?
Then, like, I talked to a director and a film student.
And so you realize you know
like,
nothing.
Narrative. So what is this movie you're working on now?
So it is a piece about grief. It's about a girl who's dealing with losing her sister, and she finds some old pictures of hers, and she goes on this journey to recreate them for her art gallery.
Oh, wow.
And it's all about, like, the sadness you get with grief, the anger, and, like, expressing yourself in that way.
That's very cool.
We've had
like
some
that.
Great premises for films from our local filmmakers we've talked to today.
Well,
I like
mean,
that.
Just, like, the thought of, because it's just very relatable, right? Because if mm-hmm. I go through a photo album or I go through my Facebook photo album,
right,
I'll get very emotional. And you see Facebook and iPhones now putting music to our pictures,
mm-hmm.
which is kind of what you're talking about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I like that. When do, and you're still working on that, though?
I am. It will be premiering in May at the senior screenings at UW-Milwaukee, so looking forward to that.
Is it done or are you still working on it?
I'm in the process of editing it right now.
Okay. What's that process like?
It's a lot. It's a lot of steps, but it is my favorite part. Just a lot of, you know, you look through everything you shot. You mm-hmm. basically create the story from ground up.
Why? I mean,
That sounds like the worst part to me. Like the most work you have to do. Like, because again, we do editing as well.
Yeah.
And I hate the editing portion. I mean, I love the storytelling aspect. I love reading highlights.
You love that?
I do sports.
The writing.
The writing's so much fun. I hate the editing. It's like the bane of my existence. But you love it.
I do. It's just something about, I think, finding the rhythm within the piece. Mm. And they always say, you know you're done editing when you don't see yourself in the edit anymore. So, like, especially with, you know, we're talking about experimental, since it's not such a big construct, you can just create such a crazy edit with those. Mm.
So how much of that is post then? Like, the experimental angles? Because obviously you can have a certain camera, what do you say, like a 45 millimeter camera, is that iFish lens. Mm-hmm. Can you do that post edit?
You can.
Or is that like cheating?
No, I wouldn't say it's cheating. I mean, there's so much you can do in post-production, like with animation and like just even in editing. Mm-hmm. I don't know, the sky's the limit. There's really so much you can do.
I like that. I just didn't know if it was like cheating if you did it post-production. It's like, oh, that's supposed to be done during filming.
The, right.
you liar.
Taking a shortcut. Right.
Well, I mean, how's it going? How's the film coming out? How's the editing process going so far?
It's going really well. I think what I realize when I'm editing is how much I go back to stuff that I originally cut. Because mm-hmm. I'll be watching it, I'm like, this just isn't right. And I'll go back to all the other shots, and I'm like, this is perfect. Mm, and then it just cool. makes the story 10 times better. And
it's got to be cool when you find that perfect shot, right?
It's so like, satisfying.
That's really cool. So it comes out in May.
Yes.
Do you have, I mean, obviously, look, you're focusing on this one now, but I'm guessing you have ideas for more?
I do, yes.
Do you have one like down the road that you're really excited about?
I am actually, yes. I am trying to work on a documentary that is about humane societies, especially, I worked at a humane society when I was in high school, mm-hmm. and their big motto is adopt, don't shop. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of bringing to light how many animals we need to like adopt. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's like an issue that I guess people don't really pay attention to.
I don't want to see that.
No, I mean, I do want to see that one's
gonna
but I don't want to know about
you don't
all
know the answer.
Oh, yeah. No. That's a great one. If you want to talk about animals that, like, that tugs at the heartstring,
that's
right
going to
get
you.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Don't do it. But do it. Please do it. That's really cool. So that's obviously going to be after this one in May. But that's a documentary, and you're an experimental filmmaker. Is this your first documentary then?
It is my first original. I've like edited some just for like school projects, and I really enjoyed because that's a whole different editing experience.
Yeah, I bet.
But yeah, like making my own, writing my own essay for it and stuff is gonna be really exciting. Man,
so what's the end goal for you? What's the goal?
Just like in general, or
yeah, for filmmaking.
I love film festivals. I've got to volunteer at Sundance before. So kind of just hoping to get more involved with that. I'm on the programming committee for a student-run film festival that's happening in April, actually. Nice. That's all about underground experimental film.
Okay.
Underground
experimental film.
Yes.
Is that different than regular experimental film?
A subgenre.
It's like two categories. Like underground is all like independent,
I'm
you know,
learning so much.
Low budget. Yeah.
How do you classify for underground experimental film?
I mean, you could think of it like underground music in the way.
Oh, that's
that, like,
smart. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like a smaller audience. It gives voice to people that maybe don't have such a big voice in filmmaking.
Right.
Really big attention to local filmmakers as well.
I like that. And you said there's a film festival coming up?
Yeah, it's called the Milwaukee Underground Film Festival.
Okay.
It's happening April 25th through the 27th.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time. We really appreciate
thank
it. Can't
you guys.
Wait to see your stuff.
Yeah, thank you.
And now we have the time of the night where we look back at
all the filmmakers that have passed away in the past year since last year's Oscar.
Oh, I forgot.
And there's going to be some that you forget about. And you're like,
man.
Oh, I forgot. He or she passed away.
I love and hate this part.
Yeah.
Oh, AB.
Andre Brower, yeah.
So good.
Cheetah Rivera.
Movie Glory, you see Glory?
Mm-hmm.
He was great. Paul Reubens, B.B. Herman.
Oh, man.
Thank you.
I do love this song. It reminds me of Step Brothers. Oh, that's Andrea Bocelli? How did I not realize that? So Andrea Bocelli is going to be at Pfizer Forum on April 6th.
Ah.
Oh, Richard Lewis, he just passed too.
He did.
Wow, I did not put two and two together yet. So Andrea Bocelli is going to be at Pfizer Forum April 6th. I'm definitely going to have to get tickets to that. His voice is just absolutely amazing. Carl Weathers. Tina Turner.
Oh, Tina.
Man. Again, I love and hate this part of the Oscars.
Yeah.
But it's nice to remember some of the amazing things that these actors and actresses have done in the memories. I know where I'll be April 6th. Andrea Bocelli, Pfizer Forum. So we have four categories.
Four
left.
Categories, the big ones.
So we got
director.
Actor, director, actress, and picture.
Best picture.
So then it is four for Oppenheimer, three for Poor Things, two for Zone of Interest, correct? Is that where we're at? Yes.
Yep.
So in case you're just turning into our Facebook Live feed, Poor Things got off to a really, really hot start.
Mm-hmm.
Winning categories that you kind of expect them to win.
Yep.
Costume design, hair and makeup, and production design. Oppenheimer, the darling, the one that everybody thought was going to sweep.
Sweep everything.
Has had a very good Oscars turnout, but I don't think the Oscars turnout that a lot of people thought.
Thought it would.
They've gotten four so far. Mm-hmm. Film editing. Robert Downey Jr. as his role as Strauss for supporting actor. The other two would have been, I got them right here, if I can find them. Film editing. Oh, there it is. Original score. And what's the fourth one?
For which one? For Oppenheimer?
Oppenheimer. So original score.
Oppenheimer's actor. I'm sorry, a supporting actor. Cinematography.
Cinematography, thank you. Cinematography.
Original yep. score and film editing, yep.
We got Oscars trivia.
Oh,
what
I like
the
trivia.
What are the only sequels to have won Best Picture? I know this, too. Let's see if I'm right.
Wait, what's that?
What are the only sequels to have won Best Picture?
So a film that was a sequel that ended up winning Best Picture.
I want to know. I think I know if I'm right.
Wait, is that on the list here?
You have them over there? Okay. Godfather 2 is going to be one.
It's got to be
Lord of the Rings,
right? How many are there?
There's two. Is it Lord of the Rings? Godfather and Return of the King. Yeah. So Godfather 2 is like the goat of all sequels. And the only reason I remembered Lord of the Rings was because I was so shocked a Lord of the Rings movie won
an
Best Picture.
Yeah.
Like, those movies don't win Best Picture. Like, the only time a Marvel or a Star Wars movie, like, those types win is when it's Joaquin Phoenix playing the Joker.
Right.
Because it's like an artsy version.
Artsy, yeah.
How long is the shortest Oscars telecast?
How long is the shortest?
An hour.
I'm going to say 3 hours and 22 minutes. No,
that's...
for the shortest one.
I'm going to hour 15.
One hour 40 minutes.
It's The Price is Right. I win. I should have said 1 minute.
Who has hosted the most Oscars shows?
Oh, that's easy. Right? Bob Hope? Bob Hope?
Bob Hope, yeah. Oh. 19?
This is easy stuff, man. I mean, they should have named it Bob Hope Award at one point.
How long is the longest Oscars telecast? I'm going to go 4 hours and 15 minutes.
I'll say the same thing, 4:15.
I was close.
4:23, there you go.
4:23, 8 minutes off.
Nice.
That was in 2002, the 74th Oscars. Who won Best Picture?
This is fun.
Where's like that?
Now I just need a beer.
Right.
I'm like at the bar playing trivia.
What year was that?
2002.
Let's see.
How much does the Oscar statuette weigh?
I should know this. I did a story on this.
I believe it's around 8 pounds, 9 pounds.
Eight and a half. Split the difference. 2002.
This is fun.
Best Picture.
Just turn the Oscars off. Let's do Oscars trivia from now on, guys.
2002 Best Picture was A Beautiful Mind.
Who is the first Native American woman to be nominated for Best Actress? Oh, the one that isn't
Isn't Gladstone.
She in it now? Gladstone?
Lily Gladstone.
Yeah, yep. Lily Gladstone. And she was great.
Yes.
She didn't say much. But her acting and portrayal.
It's not all about the delivery of the line. It's the presence. It's the expression.
And speaking of, Brendan Fraser's had a comeback. He was in this movie.
He was.
He was awesome in it. All right, we'll get back to the fun and games. We'll watch this. But if you're keeping score at home, Derek and I are crushing Oscars trivia. So if you have a trivia night, guys, send us an email. Fun fact, do you know Nicolas Cage was supposed to be Superman at one point?
Yeah, it was like a weird Superman.
I cannot see that.
It was like a long hair
happening in my lifetime.
He was supposed to be Superman. Like they did a test for it, and
Nicolas
didn't
Cage.
Go. Another fun fact: do you know who Paul Giamatti's dad is?
I do, but I can't think of his. Yes,
Bart Giamatti, who was the commissioner of
baseball. Baseball. There's a baseball connection.
Commissioner. He's the one that suspended Pete Rose. But he was only commissioner for like 3 or 4 months because he died of a heart attack.
Oh wow.
He was like the president of the National League forever.
They're going through the nominees for best actor in a leading role. Bradley Cooper, Colman Domingo, Paul Giamatti, Cillian Murphy, and Jeffrey Wright.
Cillian Murphy's going to win.
He was for Oppenheimer.
Great. Yes. He was phenomenal.
Cillian Murphy. My mistake.
Is going to win. It should be Paul Giamatti. And look, Bradley Cooper was great too. Jeffrey Wright was awesome in American Fiction.
Maybe Paul pulls off an upset here.
If he did, that would be
the biggest upset of the night, without a doubt. Yes.
But his role in Holdovers was so good. Well, first off, he's just a phenomenal actor.
He's tremendous.
I've ever seen the Lazy Eye.
Uh-huh.
Like, I feel like he was switching it back and forth throughout the movie. But Cillian Murphy was so good.
Absolutely.
And he deserves it, because I know we were talking
that role.
Our buddy Matt Mueller about this before. Like,
yep.
Cillian Murphy's not like a star. Mm-hmm. He's a film actor.
He's not a
movie star.
Right.
To me, he's been a movie star for years. Like, I'm a huge fanboy of Cillian Murphy. So this would be like him getting his due. Like, he's very good. And Christopher Nolan took a chance. Like, this wasn't a guy, he wasn't a leading role guy.
Right.
And they put him in a
massive leading role.
And it worked out great.
And what a role it was.
Oh, yeah. He did an awesome job. And again, only Christopher Nolan can make scientists and doctors look cool.
Forrest Whitaker.
What did he win for? Was it the not Rwanda movie? It was.
Was it Last King of Scotland?
Yeah, I think that's it. Yes.
Did he win an Oscar for that? Let me see.
I just remember him in like a uniform.
Yep. Let's see. Forrest Whitaker.
All right, here we go. Come
Come on, Paul. I know it's going to be Murphy.
Killian Murphy.
That's no surprise at all.
That was a gimme.
And
Killian Murphy wins.
And look, this is why I say I don't want to ever be a judge for these.
Right.
Because Bradley Cooper as Lenny Bernstein was amazing. Amazing. Paul Giamatti in his role in The Holdovers was awesome. Jeffrey Wright was fantastic. Killian Murphy was great. That was one of the best performances you've ever seen.
Crushed it.
Yes.
And I like how they've done the presenters with the five folks who have connections to each of the nominees and presenting that way instead of just one person coming up to do, because they used to do.
It's a little bit more personal.
It is. It is. I like that.
Good for Killian Murphy. Really,
a standing
really
ovation,
cool.
too.
You need to watch Peaky Blinders.
All right.
He's so good in Peaky Blinders. Yeah, I mean, Deception. He was Scarecrow in Batman.
Was he?
Mm-hmm. I gotta go back to Christopher Nolan's Batman, yeah.
Coming down toward the end of the evening here.
So that's now five for Oppenheimer.
That's five for Oppenheimer, three Poor Things, two Zone of Interest. So it is looking like Oppenheimer's the big winner of the night. Still three categories left. Actress,
picture.
Directing, and picture.
Yep.
And let's see. Yes, Forest Whitaker won 2007 Best Actor, Last King of Scotland.
So, editing, right? Yep. One, two, three, four. Yeah, so that's now five for Oppenheimer.
Mm-hmm.
Oppenheimer sweeps the male roles for leading and supporting with Robert Downey Jr. and Killian Murphy. Oppenheimer gets cinematography and editing as well as original score.
Mm-hmm.
Steven Spielberg.
I'm guessing so this is going to be directed.
A guy that knows about directing, right?
Yeah, just a little bit.
I mean, it's got to be, oh, man. It's either Scorsese
or... How many statues does he have, Larson? He's like, I'm already one step ahead of you.
Oppenheimer, right? It's got to be Christopher Nolan.
For director?
How many nominations has Steven Spielberg received?
Overall, how many nominations?
It's over 10.
I'm going to guess... 15.
Is it more than 15?
13.
13, yeah.
Close.
I knew it was around that number.
13 nominations.
15. That's a good one.
How many has he won?
Three? Really?
He's made some great films to be nominated 13 times.
Scorsese was good. The killer. Oh.
Man, this is the best director category.
Look, if there's going to be an upset, it's Poor Things in this one.
Right.
I still think Christopher Nolan wins.
Oscars might be over before 10.
Christopher Nolan. Oppenheimer's starting to steal the show.
There it is. Yep.
Oppenheimer's How many wins steal the is show. This for Nolan? Has he ever won? Really? This is Christopher
Eight
Nolan's first win. Eight nominations.
First win.
Good for him. Because he has had phenomenal. I'm a huge Christopher Nolan fan. Between Batman and this. And the other Leo was Inception?
Christopher Nolan. Yes.
Inception.
Christopher Nolan for best
Christopher Nolan's
director.
First win. And this is kind of what we thought was going to start happening.
So with that, Oppenheimer will have the most wins of the evening because there's only two categories left. It's got six, Poor Things has three. Just want to check some.
Just want to see some of his movies.
Check the Twitter here.
Killian was great. I would like to see. Oh, I got to go to his IMDb. IMDb, Christopher Nolan. Dark Knight. Oh, Interstellar was great. The Prestige, Oppenheimer, Dark Knight Rises. Dunkirk. Oh, Killian
Dunkirk.
Was in Dunkirk as well.
Was he?
Yep. Tenet is an awesome movie. It was weird, mm-hmm. but so those are the 8 movies he's been nominated for. So he's been nominated for Insomnia, Tenet, Following, Dunkirk, Batman Begins, Memento, Dark Knight Rises, Oppenheimer, Prestige, Interstellar, Inception, and Dark Knight Rises. So he was nominated for all 3 of his Batman movies, which that's hard to do.
That's
like
hard
in a comic
to
book
do.
Movie. And I thought Dunkirk would have won. It didn't, because that was a really good movie. Tenet was a little too out there. Inception was a little too out there. Interstellar was very good, but he hit it home with Oppenheimer.
Very good.
And again, I love that he took such a risk on Cillian Murphy. Because again, he is not a leading man. He's never been a leading man except for Peaky Blinders.
But you put him in this leading role, and look what happened.
He did a really good job. What am I looking up at?
Looking at ourselves?
Very cool. All right. Oh, yeah, trivia time!
What are the 2 most nominated movies to win Best Picture?
14
each. So the most nominated, the 2 most nominated movies
Titanic
to win Best Picture.
That also won Best Picture. Titanic.
So they had 14 nominations that year and won Best Picture. Okay. The 2.
Titanic is the one that pops in my head first. Is
Avatar? Question mark?
No, I don't think Avatar won Best Picture.
No.
It's going to be an old one, like a Gone with the Wind. I don't know.
Titanic,
all
about Eve.
All about Eve. Titanic, I mean, that was just turning. Do you remember?
I got to take you to trivia night.
Oh, yeah, heck yeah, I love trivia. The thing I remember most about Titanic, before we get to the next question, is when you got the VHS set, mm-hmm. it came in 2 tapes.
Yep.
Because that's how damn long it was.
That's how long it
you
was.
You couldn't just watch 1 tape of Titanic. You had to have 2 separate ones.
You had to pop out one.
I even think of the theaters
it.
When you went,
pop
you had like an intermission, too.
Man.
All right, next one. What was the first animated film to be nominated for Best Picture? Isn't that like Snow White? Snow White
Bambi.
Or Cinderella?
Bambi. Beauty and the Beast. Should have known that.
I thought it was earlier than that.
From 92.
Tale as old as you knew it was going to be Disney. What is the first non-English film? Is it the one that won a couple years ago?
First
the
non-English
Korean film?
Don't tell us. What was the name of it?
It's the disease. Or bite, or...
No,
Close? Disease? Plague? No, it starts Parasite!
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 Parasite.
You like how I
that
worked
was the
there?
One, yes.
It was disease, or it's plague. There's a piece somewhere.
I like how you got to that.
These are the... I love trivia, don't you? This is the games
I'm
my wife...
I'm definitely going to trivia night with you,
my wife plays
then.
These games on me all the time. What did you not do today? Garbage. Toilet paper!
Lock the door!
What is the length of the red carpet?
Okay,
this one
Theater.
I'm not going to get. 100 yards.
900 feet.
Not even close. That's a good one. That is the
that
most
is a good
random.
One. That's a random trivia question.
Well played, sir. You got to take me down a peg.
What's the next one? In the Oscars' nearly 100-year history, how many films has the Academy nominated for Best Picture? Oh, because it's not the same number each year. So I'm going to guess,
it's 100, you think 10, almost 10 each year, like 850, 900?
601, I was going to say 550.
Oh, wow, I thought it'd be like 10 a year.
I was going to average 5 a year.
5 a year, that makes sense.
601 nominations for Best Picture. All right, hit us with the next one.
That's fun.
That's all you got?
Oh, you
Larson.
Don't tease me like this. We're just having fun.
You got to do some more next year.
We got to do this when original score category is coming out.
Right. They are back for Best Actress.
So Lily Gladstone is first nomination. She won the Golden Globe and the SAG for her role in
For
Killers
of the Flower Moon?
Moon.
You think she takes this
Native
one?
American. Yes, I think
I think so.
But look, Emma Stone is also in it. And I know, look, if there's one movie we've talked about,
more than anything tonight, it's Poor Things.
Because he was so unusual and good.
3
and
nominations for Emma.
And Emma Stone was great. Yeah, 5 Oscar nominations.
I forgot she was nominated in La La Land and won Best Actress. That's right, in 2016. Gosh, that was that long
She's
ago already?
She's a great actress. Birdman, she was nominated for, too. I forgot.
Come on, Lily. Anatomy of a Fall. That was an interesting, interesting film. Yes, it's a legal process, and in France, it takes place in France. The premise is a woman and her husband and her son are at home. Son takes the dog out for a walk, comes back, and dad is on the ground in the snow, bloodied head, dead. Yeah. And the question is, did mom push him? Did he fall? And so the film takes you through the her legal process and emotional battle of how that plays out.
Oh, it's definitely original.
Unhinged and original.
Man, I mean, it's not a movie you see with your mom or your kids.
Well, here's the funny thing. My wife was watching it today. I was downstairs cooking. And my daughter was helping me cook, so we were going upstairs to check on mom. And mom, she was watching Poor Things, so she had to pause it. I didn't know at the time. She was like, yeah, I paused it because this is not a kid-friendly film in any way, shape, or form.
And like, even, do you remember Toy Story? The bad guy, Sid?
Yeah.
That's almost what the dad was, because he would just, like, take things apart and mix
them. Yeah.
It's like, what the heck?
And that's what he had been doing for years.
Yeah,
for,
and it's, like, I don't want to play spoiler for anybody. You should watch it.
Poor Things.
If you're over 18.
Yes.
There is a lot of adult context.
I was walking in and out. And there were a couple of ports. I was like, yeah, this is definitely not kid friendly.
But, I mean, that said, Emma Stone was phenomenal. She was great. But so was
Gladstone. I mean, Lily Gladstone. Awesome.
She didn't have a lot of speaking roles.
Nope.
Like, her dialogue was limited, but it's just because she was.
But
sick.
Her presence.
I mean, her acting of, like, how she was slightly being poisoned.
It reminds me a little bit of Leonardo DiCaprio in that, where Reverence? Yeah. There wasn't a lot of.
Yeah. Because he got attacked by the bear.
There was a lot of non-speaking acting performance. Charlize Theron.
She's great.
She is. All right.
I also liked Mulligan and Maestro. She was very good.
Yeah.
Because again, I mean, the whole thing with Lenny Bernstein is that he almost was like living a separate life.
Mm-hmm.
He's a gay man, but he married a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And like, he's trying to, am I in love with women, but I still love men?
Right.
I'm still trying to be a composer and like trying to balance a work life where his kids are now hearing that he might be a gay man.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, huh. Like,
interesting.
And she did a good job, like, being angry but not upset because she knew what she was marrying into.
Right.
As we speak of her now.
I think she might be the last nominee they're mentioning here.
So, this comes down to
Stone or Gladstone?
Stone or Gladstone. And that's been the talk that I've heard since the nominations came out.
Yeah.
It's down to Stone and Gladstone. Right, a Stone is winning.
Stone is winning tonight, folks.
I don't think there's an upset, anything out of left field for this.
I haven't seen
really anything that's been an upset.
Nothing. Screenplay, maybe? I thought Holdovers or Maestro would have won screenplay.
Right.
Original. Or even Oppenheimer for adapted.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if that goes to.
Here we go. Emma Stone.
Stone wins. So that's a bit of an upset. Even
that
though
is
not,
an
up- not, I
not,
don't know.
Not really, but.
Yeah.
Emma Stone.
You're gonna.
And that's her second win, Larson?
For La La Land, right?
That's her second Oscar win. And that was same category, best actress?
Yeah. Look, if you're gonna do some of the things that she did,
you better win something.
She was. What? She beat Gladstone, which is crazy. But again, when you watch Poor Things and you see her performance, I get it.
I'm texting my wife right now.
Good for her. But man, that was a weird movie. That was such a weird movie. That's a beautiful dress.
Mm-hmm.
Like a little flare.
I really think she was caught off guard.
Look, Lily Gladstone, when you win the Golden Globe and the SAG, you almost you,
it's almost a given that you're going to get the Oscar. Facebook. Excuse me. So one award left, and it is 9:15.
So four things takes four.
Jason, any popcorn left? Yeah, I love popcorn. And we gotta have a Barbie cupcake.
Oh, I didn't even know those were there.
We've got Barbie cupcakes just for you, Dario.
Oh, I love me a cupcake.
And someone asked if I wore pink for Barbie. I said no, but now it's gonna be a yes.
You should have said yes. Look at these pretty things.
Mm-hmm. Courtesy, who, okay, if you had to guess,
Jaren.
Who brought these in?
Jaren or Lindsey?
Wrong and wrong.
Mallory?
Wrong. Rob. He is in the room right now.
Director Rob loves pink.
Nope.
Sean.
Sean Downs.
Sean there you go, Sean. Sean, you're never allowed to retire.
At all.
You've been here for 25, 30 years?
He's been here.
How long have you been at ISN?
Since the first Oscars.
No, yes.
Rob.
70 years. Call out a number. I'm going to say 30 years.
I'm going to say 40.
Higher than 30?
I say 40.
35. Higher than 40?
45.
45 years.
You've been here 50 years? Between 45 and 50.
47. 48.
You've 48 years.
You've been at WISN for 48 years. Holy shnikes.
That is...
I was going to say you're not allowed to retire because I don't know what we would do without you.
Right.
But maybe you should retire.
I think he's earned it.
as our entire crew, who knows how valuable
he is, they're like, Sean no, is. He's like, not allowed no, to retire.
You don't know what to do. Sean is, if you don't know and you're watching at home, Sean is the MacGyver of our news department.
Yes.
Of our station. Because if something's broken, we go to Sean to fix it. And if something's not working, Sean somehow just looks at it and it starts working.
Or when we have a master plan, yeah. A vision of something like this production, Sean puts all this together.
Move your pan down and show it.
Oh, no, don't show them that.
No, it's a secret.
47 years. Jeez Louise.
These are good.
Those are very good. I can't eat any more.
If we don't finish these, I might take these home to my girl. Seriously. She will love these.
We put them just outside of Lindsey's reach earlier.
Right.
I think they're making a Trump joke.
Yep. He's going in.
And this is the crowd to do it with.
Yep. I like that the coat he has. Yeah. Yeah.
The white with
that's
some,
sharp.
With
some gold.
Texture to it. Al Pacino? Oh no. It's gonna be director.
It's 9:19 and they're presenting the last award.
Do we have to fill till 10?
No. We just have to get ready for the 10 o'clock hit. That's it. It is Al.
Oh, I was right. I knew that. Don't second guess yourself, Dar.
Al Pacino.
Hoo-ah.
I like the Godfather music.
Oh, there's a video game like Godfather video game, which is very much like Grand Theft Auto.
Mm-hmm.
So in college, I would just play that all the time, stealing cars and killing other families.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Oh, Larson, you got a shout out on Facebook. Says, super fun evening, great job to all, but I am a little partial to producer Larson. That is from Christine Seaver. Is that mom? Nice.
Hi, Miss Larson.
Thanks for joining us. So let's tell you about this thing Larson did the other day. No. Or we should ask her to tell us something interesting about Larson.
Yes. Miss Larson's mom.
Christine, if you're still watching, please let us give us a nice little interesting story about Larson.
Was he still wearing diapers in high school?
Right. What was the oldest age he wet the bed?
Right. Yes, what was the oldest age he wet the bed? What did they just do? Oppenheimer win? Is that what we missed? They didn't do anything.
They didn't do anything special for it?
Oh, Oppenheimer won, everybody! Which one? For some reason, this was the no-frills category. The most important category of the night was the no-frills category.
And we're talking about wetting the bed.
And we're talking about Larson wetting
the bed. Wetting the bed.
That's talking about Larson's mom.
That's so on brand for us.
What the heck just happened? Boo. I mean, good.
So is that seven?
Yeah, that's seven for Oppenheimer.
Seven for Oppenheimer.
That was the most anticlimactic.
It was. Ending.
Do you think he forgot to let's take a look at the nominees?
Right, because they didn't do
anything.
That. Yeah.
That's why I thought we had time. There's ten nominees. I thought we had time.
Time.
Oh man, that's my bad, guys. I was so interested to see when Larson peed the bed last.
Yeah. See, meteorologist Gino Recchia, he's the one. He says, was Pacino supposed to list all the movies? Yeah.
Someone messed up.
Because
need to start. This happened a couple years ago with who presented it? It was Bonnie and Clyde.
I know you're talking about.
When it went to, it should have gone. Oh, man, what am I?
Hold on.
Heck, this happened to me at the Emmys.
No, it did. It did.
We should replay that.
It did.
That happened to me at the Emmys. I win the Emmy, and they announce someone else. No, that's not right.
Oscars.
I know how you feel.
Wrong winner. This was.
They gave it to Moonlight, right?
It was, yes. Should have gone to Moonlight, and they announced La La Land.
La La Land.
It was Warren Beatty and. Was it Warren Beatty and Annette Bening?
Maybe we need to have an age limit on the presenters. How did that happen?
Because he just, yeah.
Well, folks.
It was 2017 when that happened.
God, imagine that conversation.
No, it was Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway.
Yeah. So obviously Oppenheimer, who we thought was going to be a big winner tonight, was the big winner.
Was the big winner. Seven Academy Awards.
Leading role for actor, supporting role for actor, cinematography, original score, film editing, best picture. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I'm missing one already.
For Oppenheimer?
For Oppenheimer.
You got cinematography?
And directing.
Directing, that's right.
Christopher Nolan winning his first. Eighth nomination wins his first. So again, Oppenheimer winning for Best Actor, Cillian Murphy. Best Supporting Actor, Robert Downey Jr.
Mm-hmm.
Cinematography, Director, which is obviously Christopher Nolan. Film Editing, Original Score, and now Best Picture.
Mm-hmm.
Coming in second, not a distant second, but three back, Poor Things.
Emma Poor Watson Things.
Taking mm-hmm. Best Actress. They also won for Makeup and Hair, Production Design, and costume design.
Mm-hmm.
And then Zone of Interest would have been third with two awards.
With two awards, one for sound, which was the really
interesting one. Which was a great point
yes,
had,
by Warren,
director.
Yeah. Who just walked, Warren's right there, yep.
saying that, the reason Zone of Interest won sound was because sound was another category.
It was another character in the film, a character itself.
Yep. Wow, 9:25, so what are we gonna do?
What's that?
Take away Shirley.
Oh, Shirley, yes. We want to remind you, because we haven't talked about it again in a while. Shirley is the new film by John... chance to win tickets to a premiere celebration for Shirley, as well as a VIP reception. Yeah, it's going to be here at No Studios. We don't know when that is, but you have a chance to win tickets to that celebration VIP reception. Send.com/Shirley for your chance to win. Nothing, it will cost you nothing to enter, and we will let you know when we hear a premiere from John Ridley.
Well, as a wise rabbit once said, that's all, folks.
Yeah.
Right?
Bugs.
Yeah, Bugs Bunny. This has been a fun night. Obviously, as you can tell, we are trivia savants.
Yes.
If you ever need trivia from us, let us know. Again, Oppenheimer, the big winner, 7 awards, Poor Things with 4. Zone of Interest is 2. Everybody has taken a couple. Was there an upset that you saw?
No. There weren't any upsets. I think it happened the way folks thought it was this year.
The closest would have been Emma Stone over Lily Gladstone. Lily Gladstone. But that's it. I mean, that is like...
It was down to those two anyway.
It was a toss-up. But to be honest, yeah. I wish they could have given out 2 Oscars for that category.
Yeah, because it would have been both of them.
Absolutely phenomenal. But we got a lot more coming up on 12 News at 10. Derek and I are going to stay here, give our reaction to the night. No one got punched, which is a
or slapped.
Or slapped, so that was good.
That we know of.
That we had some good guests. but yeah, I mean, look, Lindsey, Jaron, Mallory did a great job.
They did.
You guys said it.
Getting this
Derek
kicked off.
Derek and I obviously crushed it tonight.
Of course.
But yeah, no, this was a lot of fun. I'm excited to see what movies are coming out.
Don't hurt yourself patting yourself on the back there.
If I could move in this sports book, I definitely would.
Don't you bust a seam now.
But then, and we also saw how valuable Sean Downs is. 4 to 7 years. We don't know what we would do without him. You wouldn't be able to see our lovely faces without Sean.
Our whole crew, we want to thank for setting this up for us each and every year.
Jason, Rob, Sean, Larson, our intern. Name?
Andrew.
Internet.
Matter of fact, come on up here, Andrew. Come on up here.
Leader,
he's like, no.
News director, helping us set all this up.
Yes.
So, yes, Derek and I have fun up here. Mallory, Jaron, and Mallory have a lot of fun up here.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the people behind the scenes that actually make things work. So
and we want to thank our hosts, No Studios, for having us back here. We've done this every year since I've been at WISN 12. It's a great place to have an event like this. 4 years that we've done this here at No Studios. They are gracious hosts. We do a lot of work with them. A great partnership that we have with No Studios and WISN 12. Five years.
We're just going to keep adding every minute. 6 years.
Four minus COVID. Yes, minus the COVID year. That's right.
So
minus 2020.
Up next, we're going to want you to watch 12 News at 10.
That's right.
That's going to do it for us.
With Cyria Sandlin and Steph
Patrick.
Sutton out of left field. Patrick Palantonio's in tonight.
Steph Sutton. Who's Steph Sutton? Steph Sutton doesn't ring a bell. No. Obviously, we got a great crew. So, we're going to take a quick little break. Use the restroom.
We will see you at the top of the hour on 12.1. Thanks for hanging out with us on Facebook.
All right. Great job, guys.
Absolutely.
All right, take a break.
Clear? Watch out.